Well, hello everybody, and a very, very warm welcome to today's e-conference, in which we are going to be discussing ideas, exploring solutions for a positive culture in gymnastics, in the sport of gymnastics. My name is Andy Smith, and I'm going to be moderating over the next 3 hours or so. Now, this conference has been organised by the International Gymnastics Federation, a FIG for short, because I'm going to be mentioning FIG quite a lot today. We are joined by the president of FIG, Mr. Morinari Watanabe, is with us online through Zoom. He is connected from Tokyo, and we'll be hearing from him in just a few minutes. The Secretary General of FIG is also with me here in Lausanne at FIG headquarters, Mr. Nicolas Bouampané. We'll also be hearing from him in a short while. And the conference has also been organized in collaboration with the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation. And from that body, we have Mr. Alex McLean, the director of the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation, who's also joined us here in Lausanne for today's conference. So to give us a word of introduction, to get us rolling, we're gonna head back to Tokyo and hear from the president of the International Gymnastics Federation, Mr. Morinari Watanabe. Over to you, Watanabe-san.
Thank you very much. Good morning, and good afternoon, and good evening, everybody. And that is a second session of this video conference. And last night, you know, I was very happy and very surprised because, you know, I literally afraid this video conference, and everybody is very, I think that the negative for the harassment or something, so that will happen. So that, but last night is amazing. Many country is fighting bad culture, and many country is trying for the new format for the coaching system, and everybody want to create brilliant future. I understand from last first session. So today is the second session, and I think that so also we can get for the good information. First, so thank you for attending today's video conference in difficult time by COVID-19. Also, thank you for the many inputs you send us, FIG, before the meeting. And thank you very much for everything. Before listening to everyone's stories, I would like to introduce a little about FIG activities. As soon as I became the president, I started working on the separation of powers in the organization. By separation of powers, I mean dividing the powers into independent legislature, judiciary, and administration. Each of them check one another as an independent power. In this case, the legislature is Congress, the administration is FIG, and the judiciary is the FIG Ethics Foundation. During the FIG Congress, the FIG statute is changed based on the common sense in the world. FIG carries out its operations based on the FIG statute. And the Ethics Foundation will judge according to the common sense of the world. I have just used the word common sense of the world. The sports also has its own common sense. But sometimes the common sense of the sports go a different direction from the common sense of the world. That is not good. And that is very dangerous. We will lost trust of the people. The common sense of the sports must stay within the common sense of the world. For this reason, I asked the former president of the Switzerland, Ms. Micheline Camry-Lay, to become the president of the FIG Ethics Foundation. FIG Ethics Foundation is a section that will judge ethical issues of gymnastics fans. So gymnastics fans can report to the Ethics Foundation whenever you have problem. The federation, the coaches, in some cases, gymnasts, and even I, FIG president, would be severely penalized if they commit unethical conduct. So, by the way, recently, we see many problems happening in world gymnastics committees. Let me compare them to an iceberg. Those problems are the iceberg on the surface above the water. However, there are bigger ices under the water. If don't break it, the problem will continue forever. The iceberg on the surface means the current problems and the past problems. We cannot change the past. So in this regard, FIG Ethics Foundation will give a guidance, including legal aspects. Please report directly to the foundation or FIG safeguarding section if necessary. They will be also, I will be in your position and solve the problem. And the most important thing is to break the huge ice under the water. We cannot change the past, but we can change the future. We must create the future based on reflecting on the past. One is a problem of the organization, governance, and the transparency of the organization have to be secured. Power should not be dominated by one person or only several persons. Selection process of the national team members must be transparent. Management to secure governance and transparency is necessary. And the other issue is a coaching system. Days that the coach has absolute power was over. We need to set up a new coaching system. You know, the world has been changing amazingly fast. There were no smartphones 20 years ago. Now, gymnasts and the coaches are facing new pressure, such as social media. The way of the thinking is different between current gymnasts and those of 20 years ago. The way of thinking is also different between current parents and those of 20 years ago. but the current way of coaching is the same as that of 20 years ago. In this situation, smooth communication among coaches, gymnasts, and parents is impossible. Unless coaches change their way. So today, I want to talk about the future. Please honestly tell me problems and questions. And like last night, many ideas, new idea, good idea that you gymnasts and coaches have. You know, I'm the FIG president who is an active person, as you all know. I'm not a politician. I'm not a critic. I'm here to fight against bad habits and bad culture. So let's create our bright future together. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, President. Thank you for that message from Tokyo. And I think really what the President has just said is at the heart of our conference today, as it was yesterday. We cannot change the past, but we can change the future, and we can make a brilliant future in this sport of gymnastics. I mean, this is what today is all about. It's about finding a positive culture, a culture of respect, and ensuring a safe training environment, a safe training space for all athletes, for all gymnasts, for all coaches, for everybody who is involved in the sport. It is impossible to ignore the testimonies of abuses that have emerged, that have hit the sport in recent years. There's simply no way to not look at those mistreatments, those abuses, and what has happened. It was to deal with those problems and with these abuses that the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation was set up as an independent body around 2 years ago. Now, in yesterday's session, we spoke to the president of the foundation, as the FIG president was just explaining, that is Madame Micheline Calmiret, who is also the former president of Switzerland. And she had a very important message to share with us, and we're going to let you hear that message now.
Dear President Watanabe, dear presidents, dear gymnasts, ladies and gentlemen, I am the president of the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation, and it is in this capacity that I welcome you today. Set up in 2019, our foundation is a young organization. We are a small team, but with committed and experienced people. As an independent body, we seek to build trust and add value to all members of the gymnastics community by offering more accountability and support. We provide a reporting mechanism and legal assistance. We act as an independent investigator and arbiter, providing policies, procedures, and legal guidance on topics of safeguarding is essential. But I firmly believe it is not enough. It is just as important to raise awareness of the issue and provide education across the levels. Prevention is key. Only then we can ensure a respectful culture and a safe training environment from the outset. And this is the very purpose of today's conference organized by the FIG. There are many positive examples that sporting success can be achieved while training in a safe environment. It is crucial that you, as representatives of national federations, exchange and spread these examples. I am convinced this can help change attitudes. This can achieve positive and sustainable change, even if it may take a while. It is really time to initiate this change now, and we stand ready to support this process. Ladies and gentlemen, a respectful culture and safe training conditions for athletes should be implicit. But we all know that, unfortunately, This is not the case, neither in gymnastics nor in many other sports. Every gymnast, regardless of the level, must be able to train in a safe environment. Abusive and negligent behavior must never be tolerated. I have been seriously concerned by the media reports and athlete statements about the abuse in gymnastics, with testimonies coming from all over the world. This issue is clearly of a global nature, not specific to one country or region. I applaud all who find the courage to speak up against unacceptable practices. This is not easy, but important to raise awareness and encourage all stakeholders to working together and finding solutions, just as you will be doing so today. National federations have to play a key role in safeguarding and protecting athletes from harassment and abuse. And I will thank you for your participation to this important event. I wish you productive discussions for the good of the athletes and the healthy future of our beautiful sport. Thank you for attention. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much to Madame Micheline Calmuret for her message yesterday. As our final kind of word of introduction, I suppose, before we get into the conference itself, I'm now going to hand over to Nicolas Bouanpane, who is the Secretary General of the International Gymnastics Federation. And he also is just going to say a quick word of introduction. Nicolas.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. Well, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank you all for your participation in this e-conference. As Andrew mentioned, about 300 persons from 40 different countries are connected at the moment. This clearly demonstrates the sensitivity and the importance of the topic to be discussed today. The strong interest shown for this conference speaks for itself. It is time to take a careful look at the current situation, to learn from the mistake of the past in order not to repeat them in the future, to change the current mentality, which is no longer at all adapted to the situation, and to try all together to find solutions that will allow us to offer a respectful culture and a healthy environment for all people involved in gymnastics, as well as to change the current perception of gymnastics in the world. As President Watanabe has always said and repeated on many occasions, the duty of the FIG is not to always impose rules, but it's to listen to the gymnast, the coaches, the medical staff, the member federation, the Continental Union, in order to be fully aware of their problem and to assist them in finding solutions together. This is the reason why we have contacted all our member federation and asked them to share their problems, opinion, good practices, proposals, and possible solutions with us. I take this opportunity to thank you all for the valuable information you have sent us. I would also like to sincerely thank all the people who have actively collaborated on this project. We appeal to academic researchers, very high-level gymnasts, national coaches, sporting figures, and all responded favorably to our request because they too want to see a rapid change in today's gymnastic culture. The purpose of today's conference is not to point the finger at individuals or organization for the mistake of the past, or to accuse any person, member federation, Continental Union, or the FIG, but clearly to try to find solutions all together in a democratic way for a better future. As the President Watanabe mentioned, unfortunately, the past cannot be rewritten, and we must accept the criticism addressed to us by gymnasts, coaches, all the person involved in gymnastics, the media, the sponsor, the public. We must do everything we can to regain their trust. We are not going to discuss the subject of physical or sexual violence because there is not really much to discuss, because we all agree that this kind of totally unacceptable behavior must be immediately reported to the police or legal authorities. There are, however, other topics that are just as unacceptable, but for which it is more difficult to identify a limit that should not be exceeded. It is mainly related to education, culture. What is tolerable in one country may very well not be tolerable in other countries. We must imperatively make an assessment of the current situation, consult and listen to the member federation, the Continental Union, consult various other sectors, do academic research, but above all, listen to those who are every single day in a training hall in order to have a better understanding and a global vision of the situation. It is not conceivable to expect that solution to these problems will be given by the FIG to all member federations on a ready-made basis. It is important that not only the FIG assumes its responsibilities and obligation in terms of safeguarding. The same obligation and responsibilities are necessary and crucial at the national or continental level as well. It is also important to remember that there is always a big gap between theory and practice. One of the most important things to remember is that our duty is not to simply ease our consciences by organizing an event, increase the education, or to enact a few rules to meet a theoretically acceptable standard in terms of safeguarding, but to firmly believe in this change of mentality that has become inevitable. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I strongly believe that if we all work together, we will be able to overcome this important challenge. It is understood that the problem we are currently facing cannot be solved overnight, and that it will take some time to find the right solution and to change the current mentality. But we can make it happen if we all work together. Andrew.
Thank you very much, Nicola. Thank you. So I think now you should understand, guys, what the purpose of today's conference is. We've already touched several times on this concept of change. And as Nicola mentioned towards the start of his speech, it's also about listening and listening to you guys. So what we're going to be doing is going through four different themes today. And on each theme, we're going to be speaking to different member federations, who are currently connected. We'll be speaking to people from all over the world. Today we're going from Venezuela to Australia via Turkey and Hungary, Bulgaria, Ireland, the Netherlands. So we really are trying to get as many as much input as we possibly can from you guys. The four themes, number one, it's interpersonal relationships in the gym. Theme number two is about how we keep gymnastics fun, first and foremost, keeping that passion alive, but also protecting athletes at the same time. The third theme will be about coaches, the coach's job, the coach's responsibilities. And then finally, a very important fourth point is about all the external pressure that is applied to athletes and to coaches and how to deal with that pressure, how to protect the actors in gymnastics from that additional pressure. So each theme is going to be introduced by a video clip, which will bring up some ideas and give us a sort of a basis to go on. And then we will be hearing from the different national federations with their ideas as well. And then at the end, once we've dealt with the four themes, we're going to have a question and answer session. So I would invite you on Zoom, on your Zoom window, towards the bottom, you should have a little Q&A tool. And throughout today's conference, you can send us your questions. You can ask us anything you want. And at the end of the session, Nicola and Alex will do their best to answer your questions as fully as they possibly can. We would just ask you to please give us your name. Let us know who you are and where you're writing from when you send us those questions, because it's a little, I think it's a big complicated to get the anonymous questions through on our server. So do send us your questions. We had lots of very good questions yesterday. And so do send them throughout the session whenever you want, and we'll get to that at the end of the session. So without further ado, I'm going to head into our first theme, which is interpersonal relationships in the gym. Now, for this first video, which you're going to see now, we spoke to Anna Marie Phelps. Anna Marie Phelps is a former Olympic rower for Great Britain. She's also an extremely experienced sports administrator, and she's now a member of the IOC Education Commission. And she's going to talk to us on this topic of interpersonal relationships in the gym.
Building a respectful culture in the gym is not rocket science. It's like anywhere else, whether you're in the workplace or the school or the home, it's about relationships and people. And it should reflect the values of openness, caring, collaboration, and respect. Coaches, sports administrators, and leaders wield great power over athletes. The decisions they make can make or break an athlete's career and have a long-term or short-term impact on their health and well-being. A key part of building trust is to understand the behaviours that everybody expects. And I would strongly recommend that each season you sit down with your athletes and maybe with their parents and discuss the sorts of behaviours that you expect to see, and as well ask them to set out the behaviours that they expect to see from you and from their peers and the sort of support that they feel that they'll need. It's important to make sure that you pick up on unacceptable behaviour, rudeness, bullying, bad language, as soon as you see or hear it. And it's key that coaches also set an example and behave in the same way. Don't wait for a second time. Make sure that you're consistent and you're firm no matter who it is that you see behaving poorly. A key factor in creating a positive environment is to make sure that you remain positive as much as possible. And giving feedback in a positive way isn't difficult, but it does require practice and focus. Mistakes are inevitable, and it's really important that we learn from our mistakes. And so you too can help set that example by admitting when you've made a mistake, by apologising, and by thinking carefully about how you give feedback both to your coaches and to your athletes. Sometimes it's helpful to think about what sort of feedback you'd like and ask yourself the question, how would that feedback have helped me if I'd made a mistake? One of the things as sports leaders we often think we have is the right answer to everything. But I think it's really important sometimes to practice listening to be able to understand what somebody is saying and not always to listen in order to be able to respond or give an answer. Quite often athletes and other coaches may wish to share their thoughts and anxieties with you to help you work through it, to help them work through what they're trying to resolve. They don't really want an answer, they just want a sympathetic ear. When somebody comes to you to share something confidential, perhaps some poor behaviour they've seen or concerns about somebody or about the way somebody has treated them, it's really important that you don't promise complete confidentiality. You can't unknow what you know, and you may need to share that in order to protect them or to protect other people. There are three simple R's to remember in order to get this right: receive, record, and report. Sports leaders need to be really mindful of the sorts of targets that they set for their coaches and for their athletes, making sure that they don't put medal success and podium finishes ahead of athletes' welfare and well-being. It's really important that we avoid a win-at-all-costs mentality if we're to ensure that we keep the right culture within the sporting environment and that we're not putting people at risk. Be sure to ask yourself, are we defining success by short-term medal wins or by the health and well-being and what athletes are learning from their time in gymnastics?
Well, thank you very much to Anna Marie for those insights in that first video. I think she said very astutely at the start of that video that gymnastics, it's all about the relationships between people. And that's certainly something that we're going to be exploring throughout the day today. It's about how coaches and gymnasts and the sports administrators can build trust, mutual trust, and provide support for one another. And then towards the end of her video, she talked about the importance of setting realistic targets and realistic goals And this idea of the win at all costs mentality, that is something that we're certainly going to revisit a bit later when we come to the fourth point about external pressure on coaches and athletes. But for now, we're going to start hearing from our national federations. We're going to go to Bulgaria. So from Bulgaria with us today, we have Hristiana Todorova and Neviana Vladinova. Hristiana retired from gymnastics after Rio, and she's now working as an international judge. Neviana is still competing. And guys, you're going to talk to us about what you can and what you cannot say in the gym. So I'll hand over to you now.
Yes, hello. Hello, everyone. So first, I want to thank you for the invitation, and it's an honor for us. So I will start our presentation about what can and cannot be taught. The trust is a two-way street. So in the gymnastics halls, as in other sports, mistakes are often made. After all, these are the places where we train to get better, and this often happens through making mistakes. The problem we see is that many coaches do not find the right way to note these mistakes. Very often, in affect, anxiety, and striving to achieve results, coaches lose their temper and, taking into account the mistakes of their athletes, damage their psyche and dignity. Trust between people is the basis for the development of all interpersonal relationships, as well as those between coach and athlete. When there is a trust between the participants in a process, such as training, this process goes much smoother and gives better results. But it's necessary for both the coach and the athletes to remember that trust is a mutual process that involves persons, and we should all make an effort to treat other people with respect. Because after all, a conflict between an athlete and a coach creates an unhealthy environment for everyone involved in the process. This raises the question of what can and cannot be said in the gym. We'll start with what we consider unacceptable as communication between a coach and an athlete. We will not discuss how unacceptable physical sexual violence is, as it should be more than obvious. We'll focus on a not so direct, but no less deep and dangerous form of violence, psychological. Athletes who practice gymnastics usually start at an early age. This means that coaches work with children and adolescents, and as such, they have a fragile psyche. Therefore, coaches need to be very careful not to harm the dignity and self-esteem of their athletes. There are a few basic things that we think cannot be said in the gym. First, the coach should refrain from sentences like, "You cannot do anything, you will never achieve anything," etc. If they do that, they would demotivate their athletes, which would have effect on the gymnast's psyche and would therefore have negative consequences not only in the gym, but also outside of it. Part of the coach's job is to form habits and character in his or her athletes, and this requires also taking care of their psychological health. Second, the coach must not lose their temper in front of athletes. Neither the coach nor the gymnast can use epithets and insults under the influence of stress or anger. The coach should not lose control of themselves and the situation, even if their athlete challenges them with rude attitude. Part of that is for the coach not to be angry with the gymnasts. There are many examples in which a coach is not satisfied with the performance of an athlete and as a result does not speak to her. That way, the coach leaves the athlete feeling that she or he is not truthfully, and also creates fear in the athlete that mistakes are unacceptable and lead to anger, thus giving him or her a bad example. So the athletes should not be pampered. Of course, they should not be abused, but it needs to be explained and shown to them that they too cannot behave disrespectfully in the gym. If an athlete is impudent and does not receive a remark, it would harm the training process and would destroy the trust of other athletes and the coach. Having said all this, However, it's necessary to clarify that there is a difference between physical violence and physical lot. Athletes choose their own path. It's normal to be difficult in many moments, and in those cases, the coach is the one who should serve as a support. How can this be achieved? What could a coach say? On the one hand, the coach must maintain a motivating tone towards his athletes. This can be achieved in a few easy steps. Firstly, we consider it's necessary to reward all small steps. Children need to feel valued, and the coach can easily achieve this by praising every little progress made by the athletes. This will motivate them to continue to overcome fatigue, to surpass themselves, and to achieve better results. Secondly, the remarks should keep a positive tone. Instead of "don't this element like that," the coach may say, "why don't you do this element that way?" It is quite possible to criticize someone without offending them. This way, that someone will have confidence in your attitude and your professionalism. Subconsciously, children respond better to positive remarks than to negative ones. Therefore, by choosing the right tone, the coach will also contribute to achieving better sports results. And finally, I want to say that generally speaking, a coach should be a brilliant psychologist and educator. This is expressed not only the things mentioned above, but also in showing a personal example. The coach can give lessons to her or his gymnast using stories from the coach's personal life. At the same time, if the coach becomes a victim of ill treatment, they can set an example by not responding with the same, but by trying to solve the problem by talking. This will show the athlete that the coach trusts him or her, which would provoke the same in the opposite direction, therefore creating a mutual trust. As a result, the gymnast will be able to share thoughts and feelings with her coach, will trust her or him, and the training process will be smoother and more productive. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Christiana. Thank you, Neviana, for sharing your ideas there. I mean, as you rightly say, everybody's going to make mistakes. Everybody who goes into a gym is going to make a mistake at some point. So it is so important for coaches to find a way to give constructive criticism, positive feedback. I mean, that is the title of our conference today. It's about that positive culture, and it's about finding ways to develop this mutual respect between coaches and their athletes. It goes without saying that violence has absolutely no place in the gym in any of its forms, physical or psychological. Everybody has to show that respect. So thank you very much for that first presentation. We're now going to head to Turkey. We have Kerim Sözbir from the Turkish Gymnastics Federation. He is a member of the technical committee of parkour. And Kerim, you're going to speak to us about the seminars that you guys have introduced in the Turkish Federation.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. I would like to present briefly communicating with gymnasts and coaches. And the recent president of our national federation was elected in 2012. After the election, the experts were invited and they developed questionnaires for gymnasts, coaches, judges, parents, in order to prepare our national strategic plan. This strategic plan includes almost everything, such as facility development, equipment supply, financial and human resources, from hobby groups to elite gymnast development. Also, our national federations constitute committees for each stakeholders, and gymnastic committee was the one of them. As we know, gymnasts are being and should be in the center of the gymnastic world. Next slide, please. Since last March, this committee composed of 6 gymnasts from the different disciplines who are representative of all level of gymnasts. The committee responsible are providing communication among gymnasts, technical and executive committee. In every 3 months, committee members come together to generate a report dealing with problems of gymnasts. Next slide, please. A selected member of this committee has the right to participate in both technical and executive committee meetings. Every gymnast encouraged and has an open access to submit his or her request, demands, concern, or problems to gymnast committee. This strategy shows that their needs are respected and consider, which in turn helps to boost up motivational level of gymnasts. Next, please. The experts are invited to run this seminar for gymnasts and coaches in every year. Next slide, please. By overseeing gymnast demand and concern, executive committee of our national federation decided to organize seminar in every 6 months in order to provide solution for their problems. Next slide, please. For gymnastic topic of these seminars were experienced coaches and sport psychologists run the seminar to teach psychological strategy aimed to preventing mental health disorder, such as develop self-worth and self-confidence, how to cope with anxiety, goal setting, and positive frame for moves, etc. How to enhance interpersonal, secondly, how to enhance interpersonal communication and interaction skills. Our national federation would like to encourage gymnasts to speak up and enhance free communication with all stakeholders. Next slide, please. For coaches, the topic of this seminar were how to improve psychological well-being, positive feedback such as understanding gymnast feeling, what to talk during training and competition, what not to say to gymnasts, how to enhance interpersonal communication and interaction skills, how to create funny environment during practice, quality of good coach, be aware of biological consideration, obligation young people and gymnasts, how to promote ethical relationship among coaches, how to encourage highest standard of conduct and scholastic achievement among of all gymnasts. Next slide, please. Coaches have to attend at least 2 seminars for every year in order to be accredited for every year. Our national federation would like to convert our coaches from traditional style to contemporary style after these seminars. Next slide, please. We participate first time in Olympic Games in London in 2012. After 8 years later, we won our first medal in World Championship in 2019. And we believe that this committee has made a great contribution to our national international success in recent years. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope that you are staying safe during this challenging time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kerim. Thank you. Thank you for sharing your thoughts there. And certainly, I think a lot of people will be interested in this idea of these seminars and these committees. It's kind of this willingness to have gymnasts and athletes who, as you say, are at the center of gymnastics, to have them voicing their concerns and speaking up when they do have a problem, because I think step one of dealing with any problem is to talk about it. But obviously, as you will all know, that is often easier said than done. It's not easy, as Anna Marie mentioned in the first video as well, it's not easy to talk about having a problem. So encouraging athletes and gymnasts to find their voice is an extremely important point. So thank you very much. We also, towards the end of the presentation there, started to touch on these ideas about mental health. And that is certainly a theme that we're going to be revisiting a bit later in the conference. We're going to move on now. That was kind of, we've dealt with point number one now, but sort of talking about the interpersonal relationships in the gym. Now, there's no ignoring the fact that today we're talking about some pretty heavy themes. But one thing we also wanted to remember is that gymnastics is also supposed to be a lot of fun. You know, a lot of you, especially those of you who are gymnasts or have been gymnasts, you got into this sport originally because it was a childhood passion. It was something that you just really enjoyed doing. And that is the theme of this next video that we're going to show you now. We spoke to 3 athletes, former athletes or current athletes, about how to keep gymnastics fun. So we're going to hear from Fabian Hambuchen, who is an Olympic champion. He won the gold in Rio on the horizontal bar. Carolina Rodriguez, who took part in 3 Olympic Games with Spain. And Danusha Francis, who is going to be representing Jamaica at the rearranged Tokyo Olympics next year. So let's hear their thoughts now on how to keep gymnastics fun.
How to keep gymnastics fun. This means all to me, because you can just give 100% of your energy if you have fun and you like it. If you have fun, there are no doubts why you shouldn't do it. And that's a really important thing. Not every day, not every training is fun, but to remember why I started with gymnastics. Because as a kid, we just had fun jumping around, jumping into the pit, and just do what we love to do. And that helps, especially on the hard days, to get back on a positive thought and to focus on the main things.
Para mí la gimnasia desde que era niña me la tomé como un juego, como lo es para cualquier otra niña que ve por primera vez gimnasia en televisión. Así que enseguida me di cuenta de que una vez que empezabas a entrenar necesitabas entrenar mucho, mucho, mucho y esforzarte para conseguir tus éxitos. Entonces la dificultad del deportista está en que no siempre se gana y a todas las personas les gusta ganar. Con lo que es muy difícil encontrar ese equilibrio entre la felicidad que te hace ver que mejoras día a día tus habilidades y el saber que puedes fallar en competición a pesar de haber entrenado mucho. Entonces, por eso es muy importante pues, el pasártelo bien, el estar en un ambiente feliz con el resto de deportistas que entrenarán contigo, porque eso te va formando como persona.
We are in the gym for so many hours each week, it would be a shame to not enjoy it. So the relationships that you form within your training group, so the girls that you train with or the boys that you train with, this is so important, but also the coach-gymnast relationship. If a gymnast is scared of their coach, this is definitely not going to lead to fun training sessions.
También es muy importante rodearte de las personas que te quieren. Con esto quiero decir que tanto los entrenadores, muchas veces hay que saber cuál es la diferencia entre entrenador y gimnasta. El entrenamiento obviamente es serio, pero hay un lado humano y cuando dos seres humanos se juntan muchas veces, aunque no quieras, te involucras personalmente.
The older you get in the sport, I think this relationship needs to evolve. The coach needs to trust the gymnast knows their body and can take accountability for their gymnastics. So this could involve choosing the new skills that are going to go into their routine or helping to choose a floor music. And this becomes more of a collaborative relationship over time.
If you see doing gymnastics as a game, you never lose fun in training. If you have fun, there's no pressure and you can focus on the things you want to do. But if you put yourself under pressure and you have high expectations, the risk to be disappointed is really high. Of course, you have to take every training serious and be concentrated in every attempt, but never lose enjoying what you are capable of.
Try to view training as a challenge or a game. See how far you can push yourself. See how perfect you can be. Can you make your release and catch the highest in the gym or the highest in the world? Try to get 1% better every single day.
One main aspect is to set smaller goals on the way to your biggest goal. I was always dreaming about the Olympic gold, but it took me many years to get there. I tried to focus on one competition by another. Never watching too far because the road seems to be endless and that's frustrating everybody. So keep the focus on the next step, pushing yourself to your best and always try to be the best version of yourself every single day.
In my opinion, gymnasts should not be compared to one another. Instead, we should celebrate the small victories that happen in the gym every day. So when somebody learns a new skill in our gym, we have this cowbell here on that white pillar. And you go up to it, give it a good ring, and everybody in the gym claps and cheers for you. This is just a small example of keeping a lovely, positive, and team environment. Instead of pitting gymnasts against each other, we need to celebrate everybody's strengths.
Good.
As an athlete, you will sometimes push over your limits. You need a coach to stop you when you start losing your lucidity, when you risk an accident. For example, I remember once in Stuttgart at a World Cup in 2006, I was in the world final. And I messed up my 2.5 twisting Yurchenko. I immediately, after that vault, went down to the warm-up gym to do this vault again. I did it once, twice, three times, four times, five times. I never made it. My dad, who was my coach, he was watching this, and he knew if he's not stopping me, I would never stop doing this vault. So he went over to the vault, he took the board and went out of the gym. I was really frustrated. I was really angry about him. But that was a really clever thing, because it just makes you more confident if you know you have a strong environment around you and people you can rely on.
Yo tuve la suerte de vivir esta experiencia. Para mí, mi entrenadora lo fue todo, porque además creo que la gimnasia es un deporte muy educativo, es una forma de educar. Y por otro lado, las personas que más me quieren en esta vida son mis padres. Para mí mis padres fueron muy especiales, los dos son sordos y mi única forma de expresarme siempre fue con las manos y con los gestos del cuerpo y de la cara. Eso me hizo especial como gimnasta y pude hacer gimnasia de una forma un poco especial, ¿no? Para mí también era un juego en este aspecto porque desde que era pequeña trataba de transmitir con la música todos aquellos movimientos, pues haciendo muchos gestos, exagerando los movimientos de la cara, siempre con un espejo para poder moverme con la música de esa manera y contar historias con mi cuerpo. Para mí era una cosa sencilla porque lo tenía innato, pero creo que hay mucha gente que esto lo puede entrenar también dentro de todas las habilidades que hay y que de alguna manera pues embellecen un poco más el deporte, además de que te lo pasas bien porque el trabajo de la expresión corporal es divertido.
I believe that gymnasts need to have other outlets besides gymnastics, especially children. It needs to be a good balance between their education and their gymnastics. If they are so consumed with just gymnastics, they will start to think this is the only important thing in their lives and that this defines their self-worth. This can lead to them putting a lot of pressure on themselves and they potentially might not be able to deal with this pressure.
Hay que reconocer también que es muy importante, además de pues del ambiente de trabajo que tú tengas, encontrar motivaciones fuera del deporte. Eso genera que un deportista pues tenga otro tipo de motivaciones, que se sienta bien, que emocionalmente esté equilibrado. Y creo que es muy importante para que se pueda seguir desarrollando como deportista, porque obviamente no somos máquinas, pero somos personas. Entonces creo que todo esto influye a la hora de que te sientas feliz y puedas seguir con tu ritmo de trabajo y para llegar a ser un gran deportista.
I'm working with a mental coach since I'm 15, and I learned so many things for my whole life, not only for gymnastics. It also helped me for my school, university, for my business, for my private life. The mental training helps you to control your energy and to focus on the right things. You learn not to waste energy for things you cannot change. You learn to concentrate and to focus under pressure. You learn to know your body and your mind way better. And that all helps you to reach your goals and to be happy with yourself. Because happiness, hard work, and fun are the main facts to be successful.
Our mental health needs to be a top priority. Gymnastics is such a psychological sport. Working with a professional sports psychologist can help you to understand your mind and what works for you best in training and in competition, helping you to become the best gymnast and best competitor that you can be. Crucial times when a psychologist might help also involve if you develop an eating disorder, if you get mental blocks on any of your skills, or if you're dealing with traumatic or personal stresses outside of the gym.
No existe una forma única para conseguir el éxito. Lo importante está en tener motivación, muchísimo esfuerzo, pero sobre todo yo creo que es el amor y la pasión por lo que haces. Lo bonito de la gimnasia es que te hace sentir una estrella cuando tú terminas de hacer tu ejercicio en competición y sientes a todo el público aplaudiéndote y notas ese calor, esa emoción. Pero lo que de verdad te enseña la gimnasia es otro concepto diferente, que es que haciendo las cosas bien, muy bien, en tu trabajo, teniendo un buen ambiente, un buen equipo técnico, el gran deportista será recordado no solo por haber ganado una medalla de oro, sino por haber hecho bien su trabajo y haber sido ejemplo para muchos otros deportistas.
Well, thank you very much to Fabian and to Carolina and to Danusha for sharing those ideas. And that was quite a long video, as you will have seen. So we've prepared a couple of slides just to kind of sum up the main ideas that were covered in that video, which I think we can bring up on screen now. But I mean, yeah, it's about these things like avoiding excessive pressure. Pressure is something that we're going to talk about a little bit later. Turning gymnastics into a game, there was the really nice idea about sharing those achievements with the cowbell that they ring in Danusha's gym when somebody manages to do something new or to learn a new skill. finding ways to express yourself and that positive training environment. We're going to talk a lot today about the relationship between the coach and the athlete, but the relationship between athletes and between gymnasts is also extremely important, and they shouldn't be compared, as we see on screen there. Mental health, again, is something that is a priority. And Danusha briefly touched on the idea of on eating disorders, which was a question that we had yesterday. So a mental coach, a psychologist, can really help with that. And then the final point about having interests away from gymnastics, and especially when it comes to school studies and things like that, that is also extremely important. It's finding that balance, the healthy balance between gymnastics and the rest of your life. And of course, having your entourage. Carolina spoke about her parents being the people who love her the most in the world. And obviously having your family and friends surrounding you, giving you a kind of a protective bubble, is also extremely important. So a lot of very useful insights there about how to keep gymnastics fun. Now we're going to hear a series of presentations from national federations, and we're getting into some very serious themes now, some quite deep themes, and going back to what the FIG president said at the start of the session about change and looking forward, looking to the future. And I think that in the coming presentations, we're certainly going to be touching on some of those themes now. This is perhaps not so much about the fun aspect of gymnastics, but about protecting the gymnasts and the athletes themselves. So our first presentation of this section comes from the Royal Dutch Gymnastics Federation. We're delighted to have Marieke van der Plas, who is the CEO of Dutch Gymnastics, joining us here. And she's joined by Froekje Smits, who is an independent scientific advisor for the Dutch Federation, specializing in gymnastics. So Marieke, I'll hand over to you now for your presentation. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Hello, everyone. First of all, I want to thank the colleagues of the FIG and the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation to organize this important e-conference. And I would like to quote Thomas Bach of the IOC, "Change or be changed. For the sake of the future of gymnastics, there is no point of return." And to define what has to be changed, Monique Kempf, our president, says, we have to focus on the socio-cultural factors of gymnastics. We have to identify the problems to find solutions. Athlete A showed us the inconvenient truth. Now it's time to accelerate the transition to the next level of gymnastics. But first, we have to face the unfertile ground of gymnastics since the 70s. I'm honored to give the digital floor to Froekje Smits, scientific advisor of Utrecht University. Next slide, please.
Thank you, Marieke. I would like to explain the pixie model that emerged during the 1970s, when increasingly younger and childlike gymnasts began to dominate the competitions. The pixie model assumes that an immature physique and mind are best suited to learn complex gymnastic skills, and thus the career time frame is short and believed to demand early specialization and intense training during childhood. The abusive coaching, dietary restrictions, and refusal delay of medical treatment reported in research and by gymnasts are symptoms of the pixie model. Next slide, please. We can see the pixie model displayed in statistics, numbers, and figures. For example, in this figure, based on the US Olympic gymnasts, you can see how the stature of gymnasts became shorter and shorter since the 1960s. Next slide, please. We can see the same when we look at the average weight of gymnasts in the past. Those figures plumped from the 70s, when gymnastics were about 1.60 meters tall and weighed 60 kilos, until 1.53 meters and 45 kilos in 2008. Recent years, there has been improvement in most countries, but we have to be careful and be aware of the possible negative effects of weightening and how to deal with it in a professional way. Next slide, please. Research revealed that in the past, the smallest, thinnest, lightest girls were the most successful. This figure shows how the age of gymnasts dropped down along the years and rise again. In sum, fortunately, things had changed, but we have to accelerate the transition for the well-being of the athletes. Next slide, please. Additionally, the leotard is a crucial component for the construction of ideal bodies of risk of harm in gymnastics. It's contributing to the constitution of an abusive culture of gender and femininity ideals. These ideals create unequal adult gymnastic relationships. Research and the gymnasts speaking out demonstrate that these relations, in many cases, empower coaches and officials and disempower gymnasts in submissiveness and obedience. This is a so-called docile pixie model. Next slide, please.
Thank you, Frauke. So we'd like to introduce two good practices from our country. First, we loosened the leotard rules. In the Netherlands, more and more girls and parents spoke out about their uncertainty competing in a leotard, especially in puberty and during menstruation. In order to empower female gymnasts and to create a more gender-neutral sporting environment, in 2018, we decided to leave the choice to the gymnasts. So now shorts are allowed during competition without deduction of points. As a side effect, it will also change the way gymnasts are portrayed in the media. Next slide, please. The second good practice is extending the career. In the Netherlands, we have experienced that fostering a long competitive career in gymnastics leads to happy and healthy gymnasts who are able to excel at the highest level. The Dutch team average age was 22.6 years old in Rio in 2016. And gymnast Sanne Wevers won the gold medal on balance beam at the age of nearly 25. Now we are changing the minimum age of senior women on the national level. But that's not the only step to a better future. We also create new formats for competition, training, and coaches' education. Our gymnastics community is highly motivated to change. It is our duty as a federation to facilitate and accelerate the change and to be willing to say goodbye, that's important, to the ones who do not want to change. Next slide, please. Ireland, Iceland, Finland, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Belgium, and the Netherlands think it is important to not only change things in our own country on a national and local level, but also to join forces to create change on an international level. The highest podium of sport should accommodate a longer-term career for gymnasts. Let us set an example for the next level of our sports. Next slide, please. And to wrap up, I would like you to hear and feel the voice of the athlete, of our beloved Celine van Gerner, two times Olympic artistic gymnast in 2012 and 2016. It is time for the gymnastics community to let girls grow into women before entering the international arena as a senior gymnast. Let them grow physically and let them have time to mature emotionally. I would love to see this happen within the next Olympiada. On behalf of Celine and all the other gymnasts, thank you.
Thank you very much, Marika. Thank you, Frauke, as well. For that presentation. Some very, very important points. I know that the two, I suppose, principal points there, talking about the age of athletes, certainly the minimum age of competitive gymnasts and the leotards as well. These are two important points. And I know that Nicola Buonpane, our FIG Secretary General, is gonna respond on these matters at the end of this theme. We're gonna first listen to a couple more presentations, but thank you very much to the Netherlands for getting us started on these topics and this idea of change or be changed, as you quoted from the president of the IOC, Thomas Bach. So we will go now looking with more detail at this question of the leotards, because there are certain countries in the world. We talked at the beginning about cultural factors having an impact. And this is the case with Bangladesh. So we're gonna hear a presentation now from Habibur Rahman, who is the acting as the national team manager of the Bangladesh Gymnastics Federation, also an executive member. So I will pass over to you now, Habibur, for your presentation.
Well, thank you. Honorable President, Secretary General and Director of Ethics Foundation, and dear all, greetings from Bangladesh Gymnastics Federation. I'm grateful for giving me this opportunity to say a few words, and I will talk about Pixie model of women artistic gymnastics leotard. In my proposal, I have explained how Bangladesh Gymnastics Federation came up with this solution with the leotard in Bangladesh, which is not only develops the interpersonal relationships, but in the gym, but within the state, because Bangladesh is a democratic and culturally diverse country. It is a Muslim majority country where more than 90% is Muslim. And Islam became the state religion in 1980s. Since then, Bangladesh gymnastics has been struggling with this women artistic gymnasts leotard. But Gymnastics Federation set some rules, which are first, during training and competition, senior women gymnasts will wear gymnastics leotard with extra shorts, which will cover their thighs. These rules will be applicable for the local and national level competitions. And for international competitions, Bangladesh Gymnastics Federation will definitely respect FIG dress code. Secondly, during the training and competition in local level, age group gymnasts will wear the leotard only. I believe you all have something to say regarding this matter. Some will agree or disagree, or maybe some have different ideas, but I think everything works differently in different places. It depends on socio-cultural, political, and religious perspective of a country. Actually, it depends on people's perspective of that particular country. For example, you may all know about the Malaysian gymnasts, Farah and Abdul Hadi, women artistic gymnasts. She won 2 gold medals in SEA Games, but she was criticized for revealing leotard even she won 2 gold medals for her country. I think there are a lot of countries, mostly Muslim countries, where religion is a big issue. These countries are facing, actually women gymnasts are facing this similar problems of those countries. However, to promote women gymnastics in country like us, where dress code is a serious issue, may follow the mentioned solution in order to practice gymnastics, or we have to find some other way out. We are continuously fighting to solve this problem. So everyone, hoping for a better future. Thank you all for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Habibur. Thank you for sharing those ideas. And as you rightfully pointed out, it's a thorny question. It's a difficult question to solve. It's a one that requires discussion at all levels, I think. And certainly, I think the point you make at the end that you're fighting to solve this problem, that is a very important thing to know, that that this is something that is being dealt with. And Nicola is going to talk on this point in a minute. As I say, we're just going to have our third presentation now from Gymnastics Ireland. Kieran Gallagher is the chief executive of Gymnastics Ireland, and he's actually going to be speaking on behalf of a host of different national federations. You will have heard at the end of the Dutch presentation that Marika talked about this united front. There are several federations working together on these ideas of increasing the age limit for minimum age to take part in competitive gymnastics. So I'm going to hand over now to Kieran for his presentation, and then we will hear from Nicola. So over to you, Kieran.
Hi, everyone. Hope everyone's having a good morning, afternoon, or evening, depending on where you are in the world. We all know that it's a crucial time for the development of the culture of our sport. There are many, many areas and issues that we need to touch on. So if my presentation could just be brought up, I will kick off on focusing in terms of one area, which is developing long-term senior competition for all disciplines. So if we could move to the next slide, please. The proposal we'd like to put forward is to strategically plan for increasing the age of senior competition while simultaneously developing technical rules, regulations, and codes that promote a longer-term gymnast competitive pathway. And as has been said, there are a number of nations that over recent weeks have been discussing, liaising via email, Zoom meetings, team meetings, in terms of, you know, what we wanted to kind of see discussed at this conference, which is a fantastic initiative by FIG. And as mentioned also following on from Marika in the Netherlands, Iceland, Finland, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, and also the Belgian Federation are in support of this proposal today. So moving on to the next slide, please. The rationale behind our proposal is that we believe a longer term gymnast development stroke competitive pathway that avoids a too much, too young approach will ultimately be in the best interest of the welfare of our gymnasts. And that's due to prioritizing a long term pathway model that avoids competition at younger ages and provides a longer time frame for development towards competition at senior championships. We believe this will ensure our gymnasts are physically and mentally best placed to perform while having a positive adult sporting experience, which I think is essential. As we know, our sport is an incredibly important part of all of our gymnasts' lives. And as previous speakers have referenced, it shouldn't just be the sole part, it's part of their development as a person. So moving on to the next slide, please. The second area for the rationale is that there's a potential for a negative public perception of gymnastics as a sport for little girls. So as we're aware, we have one of the most popular and loved sports in the world. It's one of the three category A Olympic sports. We have some disciplines that have senior competitions where senior competitors are aged 18 stroke 21 plus, you know, men's artistic and trampolining would be good examples of this. However, we have other disciplines where the age for senior competition could be considered as quite young in comparison to other major global sports. And what this has led to is huge global television audiences watching our championships, whereby the average age of competitors in some disciplines is very young. And of course, comparisons are very easily drawn to other major sports, for example, the other category A sports of swimming and athletics. You know, many nations, I think, on the Zoom today will conduct various pieces of research. And in our president's address at the start, he referenced the importance of independence. In Ireland, this is something that has been very extensively built into our sports system. You know, we have independent board members, independent appeals processes to third party bodies within our country for discipline and complaints matters. But we also, in terms of developing our strategies, our strategic plans and our commercial strategies, we want to gain independent opinion of what our sport is and what it looks like to the public. And every 2 years, Gymnastics Ireland conducts various pieces of research. Some track national sentiment, others would track brand market value for the development of our commercial strategies. And overwhelmingly, we have a hugely positive national response to our sport. Gymnastics is now one of the biggest sports in the country, one of the biggest participation sports in Ireland. And it's clear that it's incredibly popular, but every now and again, we do see the negative kind of comments come through from the various surveys along the lines of gymnastics is a great sport, but it's a sport for little girls and it's not a sport you can do, you know, in the later years in your life. Now, we know that that's not necessarily the case, but obviously for some of our disciplines, it's a problem that they do struggle with, and it's something that we think that we can address going forward. So if we could move to the next slide, please. Our proposal or our ask from this e-conference is that the FIG forms a working group to map out a strategy and a framework to start the process of change. We're not expecting change to happen overnight, and we understand that this is something that is a view of a long-term development for our sport. But we believe that this should kick off immediately. And we believe that the group should consist of the following: representatives of the FIG Executive Committee, representatives of the FIG Technical Committee, VPs and key staff, representative from FIG Safeguarding and the Ethics Foundation, from other sports that have successfully made this transition from having perhaps a younger senior age profile into an older profile, media stakeholders, research and sponsorship stakeholders, other leading experts who can add value. And of course, this has been referenced over and over again today, the athlete's voice must be represented in every decision-making process for our sport going forward. So again, I would like to thank the FIG for this excellent initiative. And in Ireland, we very much look forward to working with our friends in various other countries and the FIG in terms of finding solutions to the various issues that we're discussing today. Thank you.
Thank you, Kieran. Thanks very much. Thanks for a very clear presentation. And thanks for speaking on behalf of the other national federations as well. The points you make, clearly, it's not just about changing gymnastics in terms of mapping out a longer career pathway for gymnasts, but also about changing how people see gymnastics, which, as you say, is one of the most popular sports, certainly at the Olympic Games. So some very big themes here. And for that reason, I'm going to hand over now to Nicolas Bouanpanet, the Secretary General of FIG, and he's going to start to address some of these concerns. Nicolas.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. Well, to start with, thank you very much to the Netherlands, to Bangladesh, and to the group of national federation from the north of Europe for this this presentation. Indeed, those are very important and sensitive topics that will have to be discussed. Well, it's not today that we will be able to take decision, neither on the age or leotard, but what I can promise you is that those proposal, those topics will be discussed first at the executive committee level. I also took duly note of the proposal from the group of federation to try to organize a working group to discuss these topics. So that will be mentioned in my report to the executive committee as well. Well, change or be changed. Well, that's it. Here we go. So we better have to try to change what does not currently work properly and not wait to be changed, because then we do not have any other choice than to do it. We like it or not, that's it. So there are some important topics which have been discussed here. I will maybe start with the age of the gymnast. Indeed, currently the age of the gymnast, and you were probably referring to women artistic gymnastics only, is currently 16 years old, true. To me, we will have to discuss that topic again. And by the way, this is a topic that comes regularly on the table with some proposal to increase the age. But at the same time, we do also have some federation proposing to decrease the age. So that step to decrease has already been discussed at the executive committee, and there is no way we will go into that direction. Then to increase, this will need further discussion, probably at the executive committee level, and why not to organize a seminar dedicated on the age of the gymnast to have all the various opinion of the member federation. But if I do a little bit of history, before 1980, the age of the gymnast in women artistic gymnastics was 14 years old. And it has been decided during the 58th Congress of the FIG, held in July 1980, to raise the age to 15. But then it has been decided further in 1997 to raise it to 16. So we can see that there is a willingness maybe to increase. Well, as it has been said, maybe not to have children on the field of play, but more women. So those discussions will indeed continue. But once again, we will have to have a careful look at all the ages, because now you probably all know that the executive committee decided to organize since 2019 junior world championship. So that will be also a question. Should we do that? Should we not? Is the age correct? I know that Donatella Sacchi, the woman's technical president, already made a proposal that will be discussed during the executive committee, as well as to the council, because it's related to the technical regulation, to increase the age of the gymnast who participate to this junior world championship. But then we also have rhythmic. The age is 16, so should we do the same move or not? We have acrobatic. the age to be a senior gymnast is 15. We have trampoline 17. So, well, what I'm trying to say here is that we should not just look at women artistic gymnastic, because true, it's more, well, it's there that we are facing the more problem right now, but we should have a careful look at all ages and come up with the best possible solution. So once again, this is not a real answer, because it will have to be discussed further once again on the executive committee and council level. But what we can see today, and once again, here I'm talking about women artistic gymnastic, is that if I look at the statistic, in 1987, the average age of the participant was more or less 16 and a half years old. Then it moved slowly, 96, we end up by 17 plus. Then we end up in 2006 by 18 years old in average. And then further, 2008, 2009, close to 19. And if I look at the statistic from Rio, it's almost 21 years old. And the last world champion, not the last one, but well, the last world championship in Stuttgart, it was 1991. So, well, it seems that that the age is increasing, and it's a good thing. But let's discuss that further, either at the executive committee level, during a working group session, during another seminar. I will once again discuss that and come back to you with some proposal in that regard. Now, talking about the leotard, it's true that not only for the Muslim countries, it creates some problems. We regularly receive some complaint by saying, well, it's too short, it's not fair for the gymnast. We can see this, we can see that, whatsoever. So it's not that we will just wait and see and not change everything. But let me first tell you the following. If you look at the cutoff point for women artistic gymnastic, once again, there are other possibilities than the leotard with the V cut. You also have a longer leotard, which is allowed. You also have the possibility to have leg covering or stockings or unitard, the same as they use in sometime in rhythmic gymnastics. So it's probably not the answer to those problems you're facing mainly, well, not only, but in Bangladesh and other Muslim countries. But keep in mind that those possibilities currently exist. Then once again, that topic will be discussed further. I will address that topic also to the Women's Technical Committee to have a careful look at it and to find out what can be done. Should we move to a kind of short or whatsoever? Once again, I do not have the answer nor the authority to decide on that, but we will have a careful look at this. But once again, have a look at the cutoff point or at the FIG rules, competition closing and advertisement, which is available on our website. And you will see what are the current possibilities and not to wear what we may call the regular leotard, which can create some problems around the world. So I wanted to mention this, maybe to try to help immediately the various countries who are facing problems with those leotards. And for the age, once again, this is a topic that will be further discussed. So Andrew, that's all I wanted to say on those two topics, which are indeed very, very important. And the image of the gymnast and the way they are perceived by the public, by everybody around the world is for sure something that we better have to have a careful look at and take the right decision now.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Nicola. And again, thank you to the Netherlands, to Bangladesh and to Ireland on behalf of all those other national federations for giving us those presentations. So we've spoken at some length there about athletes and about gymnasts. We're now going to move on to the third part of this conference, which is focusing more on the coach the coach's job and the coach's responsibilities. So we're going to bring up a video in a moment's time. For this one, we spoke to three different coaches. We spoke to Laurent Gelzec. He is the current head coach of the Switzerland men's team. Monica Calabro from Argentina. She has spent many, many years working as a coach and a choreographer. And finally, Alias Pegan. He was a world and a European champion with Slovenia on the horizontal bar. He now works as a technical advisor in Turkey, and he's also the FIG athletes representative for the sport of men's artistic gymnastics. So let's hear what they have to say about the role of the coach.
Concernant les rôles et responsabilités du coach, c'est une question difficile à répondre en quelques mots, mais je pense que l'un des premiers rôles du coach, hein, au-delà de sa compétence technique, d'être spécialiste de sa discipline, c'est de jouer un rôle de motivateur, à savoir déjà impulser la bonne dynamique à l'entraînement et motiver ses athlètes à donner le meilleur d'eux-mêmes. Je pense que c'est déjà un rôle essentiel. Après, ce qu'on demande en priorité à un coach, c'est quand même de faire progresser ses athlètes, de les rendre meilleurs à tous les niveaux, aussi bien au niveau technique que physique que mental.
Como entrenadores, tenemos una enorme responsabilidad en nuestras manos. ¿Por qué? Porque formamos gimnastas para un periodo específico de tiempo, pero personas y con valores para toda la vida. Nosotros trabajamos con niños, adolescentes, adultos jóvenes, todos ellos son seres en formación. Por eso los debemos contemplar como una totalidad, con todos sus aspectos, físico, técnico, emocional, psicológico, intelectual. No todos los niños aprenden con la misma velocidad ni a los mismos tiempos. Entonces, cuando nosotros nos preguntamos cuál es el rol del entrenador, cuál es el alcance que tiene, y la respuesta es un poco más compleja que solamente entrenar gimnastas.
The primary task is to coach according to a well-prepared plan with a training program that will allow the gymnast to progress continuously in a safe manner and increase their confidence. My career has been so long partly thanks to respectful approach of my coaches. They paid close attention to the mastery of basic elements. They made sure that I understood the level of physical preparation needed and the steps to follow in order to learn a new skill.
Alors, comme l'a très bien expliqué Alias, c'est vrai qu'il est très important de bien définir le projet sportif de l'athlète, ses objectifs, la marche à suivre, les étapes de préparation, le plan d'entraînement qu'on va mettre en place. Ça me paraît vraiment essentiel. Là encore, c'est bien d'essayer, si possible, d'impliquer ces athlètes et de bien leur expliquer ce qu'on veut mettre en place afin qu'ils se sentent concernés par leur projet sportif. Cet échange entre le coach et son athlète, et cette notion de responsabilité partagée, sont, à mon avis, essentielles dans notre métier d'entraîneur. C'est sûr, par contre, que c'est plus difficile avec des jeunes athlètes qui n'ont pas encore beaucoup de maturité et d'expérience dans leur pratique. Mais le but sera quand même progressivement de les impliquer afin qu'ils deviennent de plus en plus responsables, autonomes et acteurs de leur propre projet sportif. Cela me semble d'autant plus important que la nouvelle génération est aujourd'hui très connectée avec les smartphones et elle reçoit beaucoup d'informations et elle a un peu cette tendance à vouloir comprendre le pourquoi des choses. À l'inverse peut-être des années 80-90 où les entraînements étaient à l'époque beaucoup plus directifs.
When I was 16 years old, I used to train with older boys. One Friday evening after training, I went out to play a game of pool with them and I told my parents where I will be. Somehow, my coach found out that I'm out with the older boys. He called my parents and asked them if they know where I am, and that in his opinion I should already be in bed as these boys are too old for me to hang out with. My mother explained to him that I let her know where I am and what I do, and that he does not have to spy on my out-of-gym activities. If he considers the boys I hang out with as an inappropriate company, Then she will have to reconsider if I will continue training gymnastics with these boys. From that day onwards, there were never a problem between my coach, my parents and me. It is obvious that my coach cared about my well-being, but he understood that my parents kept an eye on what I did. He coached me for 26 years and he taught me to be disciplined, hardworking and fair to other people. Eventually, I realized that going out evenings affected my trainings, so I adopted more professional lifestyle and become both European and world champion. Too many times, parents comply with what coaches prescribe for their children. Sometimes it's because they do not have enough time to look after their children, and sometimes it's because they are overpowered by a coach's authority. Above all, some parents have very big ambitions for their children, and they want them to achieve those goals at all costs. It's really important that everyone clearly understands their place and their responsibilities in the training process.
Dans l'entraînement, la relation entraîneur-entraîné va jouer un rôle déterminant dans la réussite d'une carrière sportive. On a tous entendu ces témoignages de sportifs parlant de leur coach comme un véritable modèle ou un mentor, parfois même un père spirituel. Sans aller jusque-là, chaque situation, chaque relation sont singulières et différentes. C'est clair qu'on sera plus exigeant avec un athlète professionnel qu'avec un athlète amateur. Bref, certains athlètes vont rechercher une relation fusionnelle avec leur coach, qui peut même parfois être extra-sportive, alors que d'autres, à l'inverse, vont préférer avoir une relation plus distante et strictement professionnelle. Dans tous les cas, il me semble vraiment important que la relation soit basée sur le respect mutuel, je dis bien mutuel, hein, ça doit être dans les deux sens, et la confiance réciproque.
L'idéal est contar con un equipo interdisciplinario, formado por un médico deportólogo, un kinesiólogo, un nutricionista y un psicólogo. El entrenador es el responsable de confeccionar el plan de entrenamiento, cómo llevar adelante la formación tanto física como técnica del gimnasta. Por supuesto, basado en todos los consejos y comentarios que haga este equipo de expertos. No obstante, y es muy importante, que el entrenador tenga conocimientos básicos sobre las etapas madurativas que van transitando los niños. Todos sabemos que es bien diferente trabajar con niños pequeños que con adolescentes y adultos. Entonces, cuando hago referencia a las etapas madurativas, me refiero tanto a la maduración del sistema locomotor, como por ejemplo el desarrollo y fortalecimiento de músculos, ligamentos, el crecimiento de los huesos. Después, por otro lado, tenemos los sistemas energéticos. ¿Qué sistema es predominante de acuerdo a la edad? ¿El sistema aeróbico o el sistema anaeróbico? Y un detalle, y no menor, son las características en cuanto a las emociones y al aprendizaje. ¿Cómo aprenden? Entonces, en base a esos conocimientos que tenga el entrenador, va a depender el éxito de su programa.
A haut niveau, on a affaire à des athlètes qu'il faut tour à tour rassurer, ou bousculer, ou parfois même recadrer selon les moments et les situations, et c'est pas toujours simple. Pour rester au top niveau, on sait aussi que le coach doit maintenir un haut niveau d'exigence, et toutes ces contraintes et tous ces sacrifices sont à terme de plus en plus difficiles à supporter pour l'athlète. En plus, l'athlète doit faire face à beaucoup de pression, le coach aussi d'ailleurs, et on pousse au maximum les capacités de l'athlète en tirant souvent un petit peu trop sur les machines, notamment sur les périodes de compétition importantes. Alors, la frontière est vraiment très difficile à délimiter, et c'est vrai qu'on est parfois un peu borderline, à la limite du raisonnable. À mon avis, il est vraiment important de trouver le bon équilibre entre le travail et le plaisir, ou encore entre les temps forts et les phases de repos, de lâcher prise, afin de préserver la santé physique de l'athlète, mais aussi sa santé psychique. Dans notre métier de coach, il y a une grande part de réflexion et une grande part aussi d'adaptabilité à chacune des situations. L'objectif étant de trouver et de proposer une solution à l'athlète afin qu'il poursuive sa progression. Et rien que pour ça, donc on a vraiment un métier passionnant.
Well, thank you very much to Laurent, to Monica, and for Alias for those ideas. And as Laurent said just at the end of his presentation, a métier passionnant, a very exciting job, the job of being a gymnastics coach. And again, that was a long video, so we've looked a little bit at, we've made a couple of slides just to run through some of the main ideas. But you know, coaches are there to support their athletes. They're there to be motivators, and they have a huge responsibility in that respect. As you can see, it's all about helping athletes as they grow older become more responsible for their own program and get progressively involved in their own project. Again, we've had this idea of mutual respect. The relationship has to be built on mutual respect. And also that coaches and parents have different responsibilities. We had Aliaz's anecdote about his night out with fellow gymnasts, and that was fine for his parents, so it should be fine for his coach. And we're going to discuss that theme a little bit more in this section, actually, about the relationship between gymnasts, coaches, and parents. It's not just about physical and technical abilities, but it's also about the emotional and the psychological aspects. So, you know, this is an incredibly important role that a coach has, and they have to have an incredible amount of knowledge, scientific knowledge, technical knowledge, and also that kind of human knowledge, I suppose, psychological knowledge, so that you have a healthy balance in the end, the right balance between work and pleasure, because gymnastics, as we all know, especially at the elite level, is an extremely, extremely demanding sport. So thank you for that video. And now we're going to head into our next round of presentations from national federations. We're going to first head to Venezuela, to speak to Carlos Sanchez, who was up at about 2:30 this morning for a check. So thank you very much, Carlos. You are an international judge, a member of the Women's Technical Committee for the Pan American Union, and you're going to talk to us about respecting the dreams of gymnasts. Over to you, Carlos.
Thank you very much. Hello. As was said, my name is Carlos Sanchez from Venezuela. I am a woman RTC gymnastic coach and a FIE brevet judge. In first place, I want to thank the FIE for this opportunity and congratulate and recognize all the people that has been working behind the organization of this amazing conference. I want to start my presentation, and let's imagine this sequence of events. A girl of about 6 years old is in front of the TV, and they are broadcasting the all-around final of the Olympic Games. She begins to imitate the dance and the poses of that gymnast that she sees on TV. And she excitedly said, "Dad, Mom, I want to do that." Her parents, responding to her wish, go to a training center and register their daughter to introduce her to the sport of gymnastics. She begins practicing, and the emotion of this little girl overflowed at home and at school. All the time, she's upside down, doing cartwheels and pirouettes. Gymnastics has become the best part of her life. She wants to sleep with her leotard on. Her world focus on just being in the gym and do what is most fun for her. Amid all this emotion, a great desire appears, a new dream. I want to be an Olympic gymnast. How many times this scene is repeated on each continent, in each country, in each of the gymnastics training center around the world? There are hundreds, thousands of children who have this dream. And every 4 years, there are only 98 girls to achieve these dreams, at least in women RTC gymnastics. It is here where lies the great and honorable responsibility of each of the adults who make life in this wonderful sport. Each and every one of those dreams is in our hands. Our main duty is to become an example to these athletes and to motivate and train them to achieve their goals. We must be very clear about this. These are their dreams, these are their goals. The dream of each child and each young person cannot be above any other personal need or desire of any adult. As coaches, judges, leaders, and of course parents, we must create an environment full of tools for each of these young people to achieve their dreams. Now, in all of this, a question arises. What happened with the other thousand of young people who arrived with that goal and it's not achieved, or with those who pursue a different goal in the sport of gymnastics? This question is the key to understand the healing process in which the world of gymnastics finds itself today. There are children who just dream to make a back handspring, and that is so great for them when they achieve it. It is something so important and is so satisfying as an adult to be able to witness that emotion, that feeling of happiness when that skill is achieved. Being a part of that is just a blessing. As adults, we must understand that the sport are not based on winning medals or going to important events. We are already motivated by each of those things that come along with the practice of gymnastics. But the most important thing is that the practice of gymnastics is a platform where we can train humans with value that were developed as productive individuals in our society. We are not only training Olympic athletes, we are training lawyers, musicians, artists, architects, doctors, mothers, fathers, teachers, among other professional areas that will have a sport practice in their path. We wanna teach them how to manage their time, how to work as a team, how to understand the importance of the discipline and the structure. We teach them how to enter in a highly competitive job market and be successful. Now here comes the point to all of this. Many of us have forgotten our main function is to be happy. And our job as adults is that we must protect, care for, and develop the happiness of these young people who come to us to guide them in the gymnastics world. Adults who live in gymnastics must pay attention to their emotional health. We must be leaders and role models for all the generation of gymnasts who enter our life with such deep and noble dreams. We must be part of this dream, but not as protagonists. We must guide them and understand that these are their dreams, not ours. Our dreams cannot rely on others. Our goal as members of this community should be to teach each child who had contact with gymnastics, and in the future, they can walk into the society and say that the greatest blessing of their lives was growing up in this beautiful sport, and recognize the love and guidance of each person who play it a part in their training, not only as an athlete, but as a human as well. This is my story. Since I was born, I have been in the world of gymnastics. I have followed every step of my mother, first as a coach and then as an international judge. The love and gratitude that I feel for each person that has crossed my path is indescribable. It's no word that can describe what my soul feels in every competition, before as an athlete and today as a coach or in a judge area. We are in an extremely important process of evolution, and today each people who play a role in gymnastics must assume the responsibility and commitment that comes from the love we feel for this sport and create a community where future generations feel protected, safe, and respected. We must understand that the most important thing lies in respect, happiness, and love. And we will all continue to show the world that gymnastics is the best sport. I love this sport deeply. The passion and respect that I feel for the gymnastic community is enormous. And all the leaders I have followed throughout my career have left a mark on me. That is why today my calling is that we as coaches, judges, and leaders must to leave the most beautiful and lovely mark in those pure souls that come full of dreams into our hands and show the world that without a doubt, we are the best sport in the world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Carlos. Thank you for really sharing your passion with us there. Brilliant presentation. And I think that's it. I mean, everybody who stands, everybody who has the opportunity to stand at the top of an Olympic podium or a world championship podium with a gold medal around their neck, at some level inside there is a 5 or 6 year old boy or girl who dreamt about winning that medal. And it is about nurturing those dreams, as you say, and developing the passion for the sport. And it all comes under the umbrella, I suppose, of this safe training environment that we're talking about today, this positive culture in the sport of gymnastics, and that coaches have an extremely important role as role models. So thank you very much, Carlos. Now we're going to head back to Turkey. We're going to speak to Kerim Sözbir again for a second time. You spoke to us a little bit earlier, Kerim, about your committee and about giving athletes a voice, but you also have set up a family department as well, so that there can be more discussion at all levels between coaches and families. So over to you, Kerim.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone, again. I would like to present briefly Committee for Communicating with Parents. Our National Federation has a special committee which names Family Relation Committees, just for building bridge among parents, coaches, and gymnasts. And also, our National Federation is trying to shorten the distance between parents and our National Federation by using this committee. Recently, years, after parents' request, this committee has also relationship with the Council of Higher Education to take full scholarship for our senior gymnasts. Next slide, please. Family Relation Committee is composed of one executive member, two parent representatives in both genders, two members of technical committee, and two coaches. In every 6 months, committee members come together to discuss and try to find solution of parents' needs. Next slide, please. Turkey is divided into 81 provinces. Our National Federation has provincial representatives who are responsible for communicating with parents and gymnasts. This representative monitors every step of gymnast development and provide information for the parents and family relation committee if it's necessary. The further, this representative have to organize regular meeting with parents concerning their children's training procedure. And this procedure includes providing basic information about nutrition, recovery, sleeping patterns, and scholastic participation. Also, this representative spent more time to convince parents to let their children practice to participate to gymnast training because of the leotards and outfit in some our cities. Next slide, please. Each representative has to provide biannual report to a member of executive committee who is the head of the family relation committee. Also, parents have direct linkage to this committee at any time they want, because our main concern of our national committee, national federation, is built on mutual trust with parents. The graph shows increasement in number of, also increasement of rate of gymnasts, coaches, and judges between 2012 and 2019. We believe that this increasement in number is the result of the mutual trust with all stakeholders. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you again, Kerim. Thank you for that. Yeah, I suppose we're getting into this idea of almost the holy trinity, really, of coaches, parents, and gymnasts. And it's such an important relationship. It's a three-way relationship. So communicating between all three parties is extremely important. And finding this mutual trust that you spoke about. We heard a little bit earlier in the video from Carolina Rodriguez about just how important her parents were for her. And I think it goes without saying that parents are very important for children, for young athletes and gymnasts all over the world. So getting them involved in the conversation and in the process is extremely important. But at the same time, as we're going to hear now from Bulgaria, it's also about setting boundaries for coaches, and also setting boundaries for parents. So Hristiana and Neviana, we're going to come back to you because you want to talk to us about how to deal with parents when they have their own ambitions for their children.
Hello from me as well. So our opinion about dealing with parents' own ambitions are that the parents are an integral part of their children's lives, and therefore of the training process. With regards to this, it is necessary for the coach to respect the parental authority. This could be achieved if the coach keeps a continuous connection with the parent, because the parent is the one who has most direct access to their child, to her or his feelings and experience. So in case of a problem of personal nature, the parent is the one who will inform the coach about the athlete's emotional state. We believe that it's necessary for the coach and the parents to do everything in their power in order to achieve mutual connection between themselves, which would guarantee adequate attitude and care towards the gymnast's feelings. This will lead to the child feeling safe and secure, which would therefore lead to optimization of the training process and to achieving better results. What is more on this topic is that the coach often does not have only one athlete to think of, whereas the parent is focused entirely on their child or children, so that makes them more or less an authority of the child's feeling. Having said all this, it's important for us to underline that the parent has no place in the professional aspects of the training process. There are more than once cases where the excessive ambition on the parent's part combined with lack of professional training has a negative impact on the athlete. This poses the questions how to deal with the parent's own ambitions. On the one hand, parents should not be allowed in the gym during the training. Communication with coaches from all over the world, we have heard many examples of parents entering the gym and trying to interfere in the training session. In this way, they both undermine the authority of the coach in front of the child and hinder the work of the coach. Parents need to know that by leaving their child in the gym, they themselves put their trust in the coaches. They must keep in mind that the training process is led by professionals, by people with qualifications. In this sense, the coach is an authority on the professional training of the child. And just as the coach does not interfere in the parent professions, so the parents should not interfere in the child's training. An example can be given with a school. In the schools, parents are not allowed to take part in the education of their children in the classroom. Thus, in Bulgaria, in the bigger clubs and in the national base, parents are not allowed during the trainings. If the coach finds it difficult to explain this to the parent, they could turn to the management of the club to take matters into their own hands from a position of greater authority. So by this, we do not mean that parents should not be interested in the development of their children, nor that the coach should ignore them. So another side of dealing with parents' ambitions is frequent conversations with them. Something like parent-teacher meetings at school, during which the coach explains in private to a parent how their child is doing at the training session. This conversation with parents can be more successful if an independent third party, such as a psychologist, intervenes. They could give examples and explain how two ambitious parents harm their children. For example, a conscientious child may know that if he or she does not bring a medal, he or she will be mentally and physically abused at home. The psychologist could explain how this affects the child's psyche and help the parent understand that they should not impose their personal ambitions on the children. Thank you for attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Christiana. Thank you, Neviana, for this, for raising what is actually a very important point, because we have an expression in English. I don't know if anybody has heard of it. Perhaps it's just in my family. But we have this notion of helicopter parents. So the idea of parents who are always buzzing over their children's heads, kind of keeping an eye on everything that they're doing. And when that becomes too much pressure, then it can be unhealthy. It's unhealthy for the children, it's unhealthy for the coaches, it can lead to real complications. So it's definitely a question that has to be addressed. I think you make a very good point that the spheres of activity and the spheres of authority in terms of coaches and parents have to be clearly marked out. So you said, for example, that the parents should not be coming into the gym to interfere with professional matters, technical matters of gymnastics. And this is a very good point, which is going to be taken up in our next presentation as well. We're going to join Dora Furo from the Hungarian Gymnastics Federation. She works with the Secretary General of that federation and is specialized in international relations. And you want to talk to us, Dora, about really trusting in the coach to design the right kind of program. So we'll hand over to you now.
Yes, thank you. Welcome, I'm Dora Fulu from Hungary, and I will talk about the trust in the coach or her professionality. We choose this topic because recently we are experiencing the criticism of the work of the coaches and their connection with the athletes. First, I would like to distance ourselves from any harassment of others, as it is not the topic of this part. On the other hand, the competitive sport is not to be confused with the leisure sport. This latter is pursued only as a hobby, with the competitive sport it is achievement centered, and for it the cooperation of a coach is necessary. Gymnastics is a special sport as it has three pillars, which are the following: the athlete, the parent, and the coach. I have to mention parents as well, because most gymnasts start this sport as a result of parental influence. It may be because 5 or 6 year old children, when the majority starts this sport, hardly could decide about it by themselves. So the role of a coach in professional sport is about that. The competitive sport pushes the borders, so the lead of a professional is needed. Reaching the possible maximum achievement, but this may not go to the risk of the health of the athlete. Maintaining a sense of the achievement on a daily basis, and every parent demands special attention to their child, so the coach has to provide for them as well. With this, a good coach knows how important the reciprocal respect and partnership is to be developed. He knows that if the success is mutual, the failure must be also. The good coach feels responsibility for the physical and mental health of the gymnast. As gymnastics is a dangerous sport, the professional work of the coach is needed. At the same time, a coach can get into a vulnerable position, partly from the employer, as he's an employee of a club or a federation, which demands result, and this demand is always higher and higher. From the athlete who wants to be successful at gymnastics, and the coach has to maintain the motivation to the athlete and show the way to the success, and from the parents who demand service for their money. And if they are not satisfied with the results, they can take the child to another place. So, because of these partly professional and partly emotional conflicts, we need to clarify some points. It is very important to clarify rights, duties, and responsibilities of the parties. To do gymnastics is not obligatory, so everyone has the right to quit at any time, but there are expectations for the ensuring of conditions and financial support, just as at the workplace in the civil life. It's possible to be removed from the national team, which is the decision of the head coach. For this, the personal and professional competence of the coach must be ensured together with the responsibility of it. If the athlete wants to be successful at international level, must invest a huge amount of work, and in this helps the coach. And where can the coach turn to in case he or she suffers unfair treatment by the athlete or the parents? At national level, he can turn to the parents if it's about an underage, to the employer, or to the National Olympic Committee. But what about international level? It's supposed to be an organization where the decision makers are professional in gymnastics and so can examine the claims as insiders. The Gymnastics Ethics Foundation is a good initiation for this. We think that if the coach may get the attention and care which is needed for their safe work, maybe there would be less offense against them, which can be led back to unjustified reasons. If we do not handle this question, we won't have any coaches, although without coaches, this sport cannot work, as nobody is able to learn a triple somersault by himself. One example from claim issues is the weight control of the gymnast. This is important for the coach to be able to decide the training load and to be able to save the gymnast's health. It's not even a question in a weight category sport or a Formula One race where the weight control is a public event. It's interesting, furthermore, that no athletes complained against the anti-doping test as a harassment, although it is unpleasant. Finally, it would be beneficial to every party to have a gymnastics professional among the members of the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation who can enlighten the professional questions to the well-prepared lawyers. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you to you, Dora. Thank you very much, because you've raised some really, really important points there, and we've just been discussing them amongst ourselves, and I think we've spoken a lot, and very rightly so, about protecting athletes and gymnasts in the sport of gymnastics. But it is equally important to protect the coaches as well, because we saw in the video of our coaches that this is an extremely passionate job. It's a job which involves countless hours of kind of hard work and sacrifice, and it becomes it's something that you get extremely invested in as a coach, so protecting coaches and respecting the work that they do and giving them the freedom to set the program for their gymnast, for their athlete, is extremely important. Dora, you mentioned as well, you know, where should a coach go when they find themselves in a rock and a hard place, I suppose, between parents on one side, perhaps their national federation, when there's pressure on the coaches. You spoke a little bit about the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation. So actually, Alex McLean, who's here with us, who is the director of the Ethics Foundation, just wanted to just say a word on this point as well. So I'll hand over to Alex.
Thanks. Yeah, clearly there's quite a bit of interest and concern on the issue of the parent coach athlete relationship, and obviously different approaches with respect to the situation in training and who should have access to the athlete at any given moment. I just wanted to comment that we're in a situation where we're talking about fundamentally what will build trust in that very critical relationship, three-way relationship. And obviously parents want to be able to entrust the coach with the well-being and development of their child. The coach wants to be trusted in order to do his or her job properly and have the desired effect. And obviously, the athlete wants to be able to be trusted and to trust those who are responsible for his or her development. So I think it's important to reflect on in creating rules and norms about how to function in the gym, what will contribute to building that essential trust. One thing that we're seeing, unfortunately, with respect to what has happened in the past, is that it's difficult sometimes in an environment in which there are hard and fast rules that restrict access of parents to the training environment. It's difficult for that trust to exist, knowing that certain things have happened that should have not happened. And therefore, we're still at a critical phase where we're trying to build that trust. And it's important to consider that in establishing those rules and allow for sufficient contact for that trust to be built.
Thank you very much, Alex. Thank you. So that kind of rounds out part three of our conference today. We will move on to part four in a moment. I just wanted to remind you all that you can still send us your questions using the Q&A tool at the bottom of your screens on Zoom, because we will be having a question and answer session at the end of the conference. We're having a lot of questions apparently about whether this presentation itself is going to be available in the next day or two or next couple of days. This is going to go up on YouTube, so you will be able to look back and revisit the conference and look at all the slides, everything that we've said, and you can revisit all that in a couple of days. So now on to point number four, a very important point, because this is about the pressure, the external pressure that is on athletes and coaches and how they can deal with this pressure. It's something that Anna Marie Phelps mentioned to us at the start when she talked about the win at all costs mentality. And Laurent Gelzec, the Swiss coach, also touched on it in his video as well. So to get a perspective on this, to give us an idea for our final video, we spoke to French Olympian Tony Estanguy, who many of you will know, some of you may not. Tony is a man who really lives and breathes the Olympic Games, I suppose, because he took part in the Olympics. He won three gold medals in the canoe slalom. And then after retiring, he has gone on to become an administrator, a very important administrator, because he's the man in charge of organizing the 2024 Paris Summer Olympic Games. He's also been a member of the IOC Athletes Commission. He's worked with the French Olympic Organization, the Olympic Committee, and he's been a vice president of the International Canoe Federation. So this is a man who knows what pressure is all about, both on both sides of the equation, if you like, first as an athlete and then as an administrator. So let's listen to Tony and hear what he has to say on this subject of pressure.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tony Estanguy, president of Paris 2024, and I am a member of the IOC Athlete Commission. But today, I assume I will speak mainly as a canoe athlete. First, I would like to thank you for this opportunity to take part in this meeting and to congratulate you for this great initiative, because the issue at stake concerns every sport, every country, and every clubs. And saying there is a problem, it's already working on the solution. When you are an athlete, first, the first person who puts pressure on you, it's yourself. That's what defines an athlete. You always want to do more, to train more, to test new techniques, to face new partners. Even when you are injured, it's very difficult to stop. Athletes are already put under a lot of pressure, so the main challenge is to protect them from any additional stress. And an additional stress can come from everywhere: family, doctors, fans, sponsors, staff, members of your federation, NOCs, media, politicians, government. An athlete often represents much more than just a competitor. It can represent hope, fame, influence, money. Depending on the context, depending on the country, depending on the sport, pressure can come from very different areas. Every situation is different. As sport leaders, it's our role to protect athletes from extra pressure. It's the collective responsibility for everyone whose mission is to evolve in contact with the athletes. What can we do concretely? First, we can identify the risk areas, because an athlete does not always realize when it's too much to deal with. But we know we will never be able to neutralize every pressure sources. I remember people coming to me, tapping on my shoulder and say, "We can count on you, Tony." Of course, it's very nice, but it's also a way to put pressure. And it's another reminder of the issue at stake. So the federation role is to offer an athlete the tools to deal with the pressure. When I arrived in Beijing for the 28 Games, I was a double Olympic champion and I had been selected as the flag bearer of the French Olympic team. And I failed in the semi-finals. After this failure, I extended my psychological support and it helped me a lot. Getting a mental coach in your team shouldn't be a taboo. It helped me a lot to focus on what I had to do, even when I was under a lot of pressure. To focus on the race itself and not on the consequences of the race. This can be a first track to guide you, and I'm sure together you will find many other ways to protect athletes and coaches from external pressure. I wish you useful discussions. Thank you again for this initiative, because we need the athletes to carry on inspiring us.
Thank you very much to Tony Estanguy for sharing his ideas with us there. And he makes the very good point that pressure starts with the athlete, We heard a little bit earlier on, we heard Fabian Hambuchen talking about his twisting Yurchenko and going down to the gym and wanting to get it absolutely right. And so protecting athletes, identifying those sources of pressure and helping to protect coaches and gymnasts is extremely important. I mean, evidently, you cannot do away with pressure altogether. As we know, the pressure is a part of the sport. It's a part of every elite sport, as Tony pointed out. But it's about identifying those places where the pressure is needless or the pressure can be attenuated in some form to make things easier, essentially, for the athlete. And he mentioned again the impact that a mental coach can have as well. So thank you to Tony. We're now going to head into our next round of presentations. We're going to head first to Germany to speak to the German Gymnastics Federation. Ulla Koch is the head coach of the female national team. Hello, Ulla. You're also involved in the coaches education program. So we'll hand over to you now for your presentation.
Hello, everybody. I'm proud to hear all these things I heard, and I want to show you my presentation now. For me, the most important thing of protecting athletes and coaches for external pressure is that we will create a culture of sympathy and understanding. Can you please? Thank you. For me, the coaches are the connectors between several systems, between my federation, between the parents, and between a lot of many persons. And therefore, it's very important to educate coaches and develop coaches, for example, with mentoring relationships between more experienced and less experienced coaches. It's not only our goal to intermediation of physical and technical education. It's very important that the coaches learn to have patience and to make a difference between the several characters of our gymnasts. We have to develop and observe these young ladies and young children. The education camps, please stay with on the first slide, please. We have education camps, for example, with our national team and with young coaches who are in our education system. We have e-learning sessions, we give seminars, and for example, we had a big seminar, how to manage the capacity of the mental health of our athletes, because during the COVID time, we had lots of problems with the motivation and with to precise the goals we have to had. And therefore, it's important to educate the coaches to have the ear and the eyes for these athletes. We have instructed some things we need. For example, think and talk about the starting of the age of athletes is also a big theme in our federation. And we also discussed to raise up the age of 18. My experience is that my team, it was the oldest team at the last World Championships. And I learned that these young ladies are educated to be free, to be able to speak about the things they want to say. And it's a great honor to work with such young ladies who are in such good shape mentally shape, and but we also have to decide, do you want to have Youth Olympic Games? For me, it's too, they are all too young, and if you want to reduce the pressure, we have also think about all these themes. Protecting little kids, we have a system in Germany, it's called Make Children Strong. It develops games and tools for coaches to support athletes' personal developments. The skills are promoted by small games in the areas of communication, cooperation, trust, adventure, and experience. For me, it's also very important to have a coach, the coach system, that the coaches know how to handle this girls. Please, the next slide. We cooperate with the German Sports University in order to collect data about coaches, athletes, and relationships. And athletes and coaches were asked about the relationships, about the closeness, experiences of violence as an athlete and or as a coach. One result is that coaches feel very responsible for their athletes and even regarding private matters. And this is a very important thing. The data collections is now finished and the results are part of workshops for coaches to reflect on their role. In this project, we also work together with other sports federation to get experiences, for example, for equestrian federation. And this can show us how they work and which difficulties other federations will have. For me, a respecting culture in training primarily means that we agree together with the association, with the club structure, the trainers and the athletes, that we have the same philosophy and potential and results. We have to determine our goals, but we also have to re-agree our milestones. We also, in this pandemic situation, we lost our European Championships, we lost the Olympics, and we also have to re-agree all these milestones and our goals. And this is the most important thing to create culture and to manage these things. The objective is and the realistic implementation must agree between all those involved in order to guarantee a good training atmosphere. If the goals in our whole project are not the same, the kids will broken down and also the coaches. And this is my biggest philosophy that we have to live this change and not only to speak about this, to be very serious and to ask everybody in our system, how do you feel and where do we want to go? Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ulla, for your presentation. And for those people who aren't aware, Ulla was actually recognised by the International Olympic Committee for her coaching work at the start of this year. So certainly, when someone is sharing their ideas like this, we will certainly be listening. And it's great to see that the German Federation is innovating, as we've seen with the mentoring programs between coaches, the Kinderstarkmachen program as well, helping to create this safe environment for children. And again, it's all about this positive culture, the culture of sympathy and understanding, as you said there, Ulla. So thank you very much for those thoughts. We will move on to our next presentation. We're heading back to Bulgaria. So we're joining Christiana and Neviana again. And they're going to talk about how sports administrators and management have to respect the work of the coach and respect their authority in public. So back to you, Christiana and Neviana.
Thank you. So I will speak about the management should respect coaches' work and authority in public, present a united front in front of the athlete. So we consider the management and the coach as similar to the child's parents. And just as both parents need to show that they support each other and have the same opinion in front of the child, so the management and the coach need to present a united front to the athlete so that the athlete knows that they have her or his interest in mind and that she or he can trust both instances. Achieving this reciprocity depends on both the management and the coach. On one hand, the management is in a position of power and therefore must be very vigilant not to undermine the coaching authority in the eyes of the children. It's necessary for the management not to go over the coach's head and, in case of desire, to intervene in a specific stage of the preparation to inform the coach in due time. Because if the coaches and the management disagree in front of the child, he or she is confused about what to do and would probably rather listen to the management. As a result, the child will lose confidence and respect for the coach and may never listen to the coach ever again. What management could do as a preventative measure is to introduce specific rules that it requires to be followed. It's possible for management to demand results from the coach and the athlete without destroying their relationship. As for the coaches, they should inform the management as often as possible about the athlete's condition, how the athlete is developing, whatever he or she is progressing or not, what can be expected from him or her. However, we would like to open a bracket. Sometimes some things remain only between the coach and the athlete in order for the coach to keep the athlete safe. This is how trust is built. For example, a situation where a gymnast is a little outside the weight the management requires. In that case, the coach can tell the management that she is in kilograms, her weight today is okay, but does not go specific and therefore does not lie about how many kilograms she actually weighs. After a few days, the weight is achieved. This example falls under the category no harm, no foul. In this way, the coach shows the child that they can be trusted. As a result, the coach will set an example for the child not to disrespect either his or her coach or his or her teammates in front of the management. By observing all this, the management and the coach will be able to hide the problems that would disrupt the training so that it may go undistracted and undisrupted. It should always be borne in mind that the one who represents during the competition, the management and the coach and the country is the athlete. Therefore, the calm atmosphere for the preparation of the athlete must be ensured as much as possible. This is extremely important for the overall success of the sport. In front of the athlete, both the coach and the management must be able to do one thing that is very important: to maintain the authority and hierarchy of both the coach and the management in order to educate and relay the athlete to these two important institutions. This can only be achieved with mutual respect. Thus, if a coach and management have disagreements regarding the preparation, they must hold a preliminary conversation where it's discussed in detail and a unified decision is reached, concerning only the optimal condition of the athlete. But what should be done if they cannot agree? In our opinion, in such a case, one of the two institutions assumes the responsibility to make a decision alone and is responsible for implementation. Accordingly, it bears consequences of the decision. If all this is specified in advance, then there will be no separation between coach and management, and the athlete will feel cared for by all parties involved. Thank you.
Thank you again, Christiana Neviana. Thank you very much. A bit earlier on, I spoke about the triangle between the athletes, the parents, and the coaches. And I suppose in some ways we can make it a square now, because there is also, of course, management to consider. And it is extremely important, as you guys point out, that there is a united front. And the pressure, as we heard from Tony Estongue, can often come, it comes from the top down. The pressure arrives often from the top. It can go even higher than administrators, all the way up to governments, etc. But it is extremely important for there to be planning, for there to be discussions held between the administrators, the management, and the coaching figures. You mentioned that they shouldn't be having arguments, they shouldn't be putting athletes into a difficult position of knowing to which authority figure they should defer. So some really excellent points there, and ultimately it comes back to this idea of mutual respect. We're going to just talk a little bit more specifically now about safeguarding structures, about how we can make this safe training environment that we have been discussing and mentioning since the start of the conference. So we're joined from Australia, from Gymnastics Australia. We're joined by Brooke Irvine. Her role is that she is the National Child Safety Manager for Gymnastics Australia. So we're going to hand over to her now for her presentation. Over to you, Brooke.
Great, thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity today to talk to you about three technology projects that Gymnastics Australia has been working on to allow us to share information across Australia with our clubs and with our associations, as well as gain information from government organisations as well. Next slide, please. Today, we're going to talk to you about our flagging system, our event working with children checks, and our validation of working with children checks from a technology perspective. Next slide, please. So our flagging system allows us to identify if there's been any concerns or issues with our members. We can flag each member with green, amber, or red, as you can see in the bottom corner of the slide. The flag is shown when you search on an individual in the database. And the colour of the flag is based on the level of concern about an individual. We can also provide basic detail about the concerns to each individual's profile. Next slide, please. Once we have set up a flag in the database, as you can see here, this flag is red due to child safety concerns raised at a state association level. We can add actions about where to go and what the concern is. We can also add further notes or credible evidence if required. If there are ever changes to this section, we can also see these changes in the change history. The change history cannot be altered at any point in time, and there is always a permanent record in this area, which is provided for evidence in the future if required. This information can be seen at all levels of our sport, which assists when coaches change and go from club to club or move interstate. We'll always have this information. Next slide, please. And just click through. This is the actions, the notes, and the change history and information. Next click. Our second project is checking individuals working with children's checks. These are government requirements for everyone who works with children in Australia. So we check these details with the governments through our database prior to providing accreditations at all of our events. We cross-reference the information with photo ID, which can be passports or driver's license. And this way we can make sure that all people accredited at our events and competitions have been cleared to be around children. Next slide, please. We also have the ability to validate or to verify the checks with the government departments to make sure that there are no concerns or revoked checks, as the government has so much more access to information such as law enforcement reports and also background checks on individuals. The validation can be conducted again, at all levels of our sport, at our clubs, our associations, and at our national level. Every time we validate a check, the Working with Children check details, this information is stored in our database. It provides information on who conducted the check, when the check was conducted, and the outcome of the check. As you can see here, this check is current and valid. And this information is provided from the government departments. The information is stored so that we can then use this information again as evidence that a validation of someone's working with children check was conducted, which is really important again for historical purposes. So thank you for allowing me to provide you with some information about our three projects that we're working on to try and keep children safe in our country.
Yeah, thank you very much to you, Brooke. Thank you for sharing those ideas. And as you say, it's so important. The safe environment and protecting our youngest and most vulnerable gymnasts is, of course, and extremely is perhaps the highest priority. So thank you very much for sharing those ideas. So I'm going to talk now, we're going to hear now from Ellen McPherson in Canada. She is the director of Safe Sports Canada. Ellen, I think you're with us.
Yes, I'm here. Hello, everybody.
Hello, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. My name is Ellen McPherson, and I'm the Director of Safe Sport at Gymnastics Canada, as Andrew said. I'm so pleased to be here with you today discussing this important topic of safe sport. So by way of background, Gymnastics Canada hired a full-time employee to direct safe sport programming in 2018. The first task of Gymnastics Canada was to develop a safe sport framework in alignment with our provincial federations, basically to serve as the overarching vision of Safe Sport at Gymnastics Canada, as well as outline the corresponding policy, education, and advocacy initiatives required to help create a safe, healthy, positive, and inclusive environment. Our first initiative was a revision and development of the Safe Sport policy suite, and that included a national Safe Sport policy that outlined the vision for Safe Sport at Gymnastics Canada, a revised code of ethics and conduct, an abuse, maltreatment, and discrimination policy, a complaints and discipline policy, and then a national travel policy. All of these policies are designed to enhance the welfare, safety, and protection of all of the stakeholders in our environment, and we continue to work on further policies to add to this suite. In Canada, we're working to develop a sport-wide independent mechanism to address safe sport concerns. However, in the meantime, we have revised our own complaint management structure to ensure a safe, fair, independent, neutral, and expert-led process. And that is what FIG has asked me to share for you today. Next slide, please. So I'm just going to share a very brief version of our process. If you would like to review in more detail, it is available in depth on our website. But in general, our process strives to remove Gymnastics Canada from the complaint management process, particularly around decision-making of the process as much as possible and have it led by independent experts. So beginning in the red box at the top, the first step is that Gymnastics Canada will receive a formal complaint, which is typically sent directly to us. However, there is also a 1-800 number in Canada that can be used as a referral service for initiating complaints. The next step is that the Safe Sport Director will review the complaint, and that's to verify jurisdiction of the complaint, as well as to ensure that the complaint contains sufficient information to proceed and constitutes potential code of ethics and conduct violations. The complaint is then sent directly by the Safe Sport Director to a volunteer independent expert called a welfare officer or harassment officer, and they serve the purpose of evaluating and assessing the substance of the complaint. This person has expertise in participant welfare, safety, and protection. The next step has two possible outcomes at this stage, and the outcomes are determined by that independent welfare officer that I mentioned. The first is that if the parties are willing to work together to resolve the issue, the independent welfare officer may engage in mediation or educational measures to address the complaint. The second is determined again by the independent welfare officer, and it's either that the independent welfare officer conducts an investigation or the hired third party individual conducts an investigation. Regardless of who conducts it, at this point, the complaint matter is treated as allegations and does not imply guilt or misconduct. Next slide, please. So once the investigation is completed, a report is developed that issues a finding of fact related to the allegations that were brought forward. And that report is then reviewed again by the neutral welfare officer, and one of three recommendations can be made by that individual. The first option is that the complaint should be dismissed. The second option is that the complaint should be referred to the independent discipline panel. And the third option is that the complaint should be dealt with as a minor infraction. And in that case, the Gymnastics Canada policy would determine the next steps. If we focus in on the complaint being referred to the discipline panel, essentially what happens at this point is that Gymnastics Canada will strike a discipline panel that has is made up of two legal experts external from Gymnastics Canada, as well as a gymnastics expert. At this point, both parties involved have the opportunity to veto any of the candidates brought forward to ensure that it's fair and that there's no conflicts of interest in the panel. After that, the panel will hold a hearing where both sides have an opportunity to present their material to the panel. After that, the independent panel then deliberates and imposes sanctions if necessary, but at this point, both parties still have an opportunity to appeal if it's warranted. However, at this point, if the panel decision is accepted, then the resolution is reached and Gymnastics Canada will impose the penalties that have been suggested by the discipline panel. So that's it for me and a brief introduction to our process, but please feel free to visit our website if you want more information about the process that I spoke about or the Safe Sport framework, or you can reach us by email below to collaborate. I thank you for your time and to FIG for the opportunity to present.
Thank you very much, Ellen. Thank you for that presentation. And before we head into our question and answer session, I'm just going to hand over to Nicola, who just wants to just say a few words on this final theme of external pressure. So, Nicola, you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. Well, indeed, I think that this external pressure is a very serious topic that we should for sure not underestimate. It has been mentioned by Anna Marie Phelps, who mentioned medals first or result first, win at all costs. It has been mentioned also by Laura Gelzek, coach in Switzerland, or Tony Estanguet. If you look at what we have heard the last months, seen in the newspaper, whatever, when the gymnasts speak out, all of them, almost all of them, are from the elite level. And even more in the Olympic discipline. So what does that mean? I think that those gymnasts and coaches also, because we should not only point the finger out to coaches, they also get a massive pressure. So we should consider the following, that sometimes the pressure can come from the very top, even from the government. They should not, according to the Olympic Charter and so on, they should not be political interference within NOC, National Federation, but well, we all know that sometimes it happens. So that pressure coming sometimes from the government or the National Olympic Committee, which is then put on the National Federation, for example, by saying, well, you better have to qualify a team for the next Olympic Games, or you will see your budget next year, or maybe we will remove that discipline from the program, etc. So at the national level, they are getting also a huge pressure. What happened next? They speak with the coaches, and they just forward the message by saying, well, if we don't qualify a team, we will have no budget next year, and blah, blah. And then the coach has to absorb that pressure. Is the purpose of his job is to train the gymnast, not to have to that load on the shoulder, that massive pressure. But sometimes, and when I was discussing with top level gymnasts, they were telling me sometimes the coaches came in the gym and just said, well, guys, we have no other choice than to qualify, or we're going to have huge problem next year. So imagine all of this, that pressure coming from the top. This is clearly, to me, one of the key to be considered when we think about a better future. So this is what I just wanted to add, Andrew, even though it has been mentioned several times during the conference. But if it's mentioned several times, it means also that it's something which is serious and sensitive. Back to you, Andrew.
Thank you very much, Nicola. Okay, so we're now going to open up the question and answer session. Just a reminder then that I'm here with Nicola Buonpane, who is the Secretary General of the International Gymnastics Federation, and with Alex McLean, who is the Director of the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation. So they're going to be answering the questions now that you've been sending in over the course of this conference. The first question comes from Australia. This is from Phoebe, who is a child safe manager at Gymnastics Victoria in Australia. And she asks, when coaches receive a FIG accreditation, do we include interpersonal coaching relationships into the education units? Does the course provide content about how to provide feedback in a positive way? And if this is not included, is it something that is being reviewed? So I think I'm turning this one to you, Nicola.
Yes, thank you, Andrew. So, well, the answer to the question, when coaches receive a FIG accreditation, do we include interpersonal coaching relationship, etc., is no. No, at the moment, a coach who wants to be accredited has to go through a national federation. Either his national federation or the one he, she is working for. That's it. They just register him like this. But we have been asked by the Gymnastic Ethics Foundation also to have a better track and trace, if I may say so, of the coaches. Once again, it's not to say that they are the problem, no. But we do have an athlete database with various information, with biography, with the result and all of this. We do have a medical database where we make sure first that the people who will attend the World Championship have the necessary education and all of this. They have to provide us some documents so then we can validate their request. So, but we have nothing for the coach. So we are currently developing a kind of same database where we will ask some, well, at least a confirmation letter coming from the National Federation that the coach has the necessary education to be at that level. But at the same time, we will ask the coach prior to be able to activate his or her position to answer to some short questionnaire on the online. One of them will be related to anti-doping, and we will have for sure one which will be dedicated to safeguarding. It won't be a huge questionnaire, but at least this make them aware of the main topic and the most important messages that we would like to make them aware of. Talking about coaches and specific education in interpersonal coaching relationship, we currently have in the education side academies program. So those programs are dedicated to coaches. Duration is a week more or less, and coaches attend. We select experts, and there is a theoretical part, and there are lectures which are given to all coaches. And this lecture includes interpersonal relationships. So we try to work on that, but we are also of the opinion that it's due to the current situation, and even it's maybe not sufficient. So just for you to know, I mentioned it a little bit earlier, that we are currently reviewing the concept of education, because even though it's a fantastic job that has been developed by our friend Ardy Fink, the academy program, we have to live with today's reality. In other words, all these resources and materials should be available on the website. People should not need to travel to attend those courses. So we are currently developing there also an e-learning platform where our education commission is very much involved, and we will for sure not forget to include lectures about interpersonal relationships, safeguarding, and all these important topics.
Thank you, Nicola. I'm going to stay down under, stay in Australia for another question here from Caroline James. And Caroline asks the question, because we talked about coaches and parents and the relationship between the two. She says, how do you address the situation if the coach is also the athlete's parent? They're coaching their son or daughter at clubs and events, and clearly they become emotionally involved with the performance of their gymnast, their son or daughter. And I think, Alex, you were going to field this one.
Sure, and thank you for the question. I think it's important to understand what's going on in this dynamic. First of all, emotional involvement is not necessarily something that's limited to the scenario in which the parent is coaching. Could very much imagine a coach who's emotionally involved, who's not necessarily a parent just by virtue of that tight relationship. The other thing that's worth considering is that emotional involvement is not necessarily negative per se. Emotional involvement can mean being supportive, getting excited about the prospect of success. All of these things are motivational. Where it becomes potentially problematic is when emotions run high in a situation in which sort of results at all costs type situation, and you know, the resulting disappointment or prospect of lack of success becomes played out. And again, that's a situation that can happen regardless of whether or not the parent is the coach. Obviously, it's a little bit more complicated if things are not going as they should, and if there is poor practice or if there is abuse in that kind of context. The fact that the parent is the coach makes this private domestic situation. There are mechanisms that exist at the state level to deal with that. I'm thinking in particular of child protection services. So if anyone becomes aware of this, obviously what makes it that much more pernicious is that the child in that situation, whose notions of right and wrong are typically defined by their parents, will not necessarily recognize that what is going on is wrong. And that's when outside intervention is necessary. So anyone that's aware of that should report the issue in case of doubt, either to the relevant state authorities or to us, and we can help guide them.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you. A question here from, which this is on a slightly different topic, nothing that we've particularly covered in today's conference so far. This comes from Chris Lakeman. And Chris asks, are the steps being discussed to develop the judging criteria for gymnastics competitions to provide a less harsh and a more inclusive or fair environment? He says we can make a better system and culture as coaches, but ultimately we're affected by what is rewarded or not rewarded in sport at competitive level. This is greatly impacted and often going against what we've been talking about today, body type and leotards, etc. So what can we do to further ensure that the entire system is supporting these new and necessary changes?
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you, Chris, for that question. You're right. I think that this is a topic that we will have to include within the various discussion and reflection we are doing as far as external pressure is concerned. Because it's true that the gymnast to start with, but the coaches also must be able to trust the judges and the notes they receive. And sometime we had some cases where it was not always the case. I think that the situation now is much better, even though it's not perfect and there is still room for improvement. What I can tell you on that is, yes, we are currently looking at those cutoff points very carefully. And we started with the ones we are of the opinion, and that was a request from President Watanabe, that we have to look at first. Is rhythmic gymnastic, in our opinion, things have to change a little bit in there. I'm not saying that the current code is not good, but the perception of the discipline may not be properly understood. Furthermore, the cutoff point is very difficult to understand. for a non-gymnastic expert. Even I get lost in there. And once again, we are also of the opinion that there is far too subjectivity. A cutoff point should be objectivity. It's yes, it's no. Then you can have some hesitation sometime, but still. So having said that, we are starting with rhythmic gymnastics, but with the aim after, if the various working group which have been created to discuss about that, which include coaches, which include technical committee members and all of this, we want to be inclusive for those discussions, then we will have a look at the other discipline. So just to try to have a better understanding of the situation. What I can tell you for now is that, fortunately or unfortunately, I don't know what to say exactly on that one. It's judges, human people who are judging athletes. And as soon as you have human people, you are at risk to have mistakes. Let's call it that way. And those mistakes are, mistakes that a machine would not do. So of course we are monitoring the judges after every competition. We are not doing the police, but we just want to have a better understanding of the situation, of the capacity of the judges, because then when we select them for the World Championship or for the Olympic Games, we want to have the best ones to make sure that the score is as accurate as possible. But we also have to be honest, we also are looking at bias from a judge or things like this. So we have a very robust judges evaluation program in place. And this is valid not only for artistic, but for all discipline. In addition to that, you probably have heard that concern artistic gymnastic only. We have an agreement and a partner, which is called Fujitsu. Who is trying to, they did a great work so far to develop a three-dimensional system which is capable to recognize all the movement, the angles, and at a medium term, hopefully at a short term, we'll be able to come up with a D-score, for example. So to me, the day we will not have any more judges on the field of play, around the apparatus or outside the field of play, it's not for tomorrow. It will take time, but it's probably part of the system that will be implemented in the future. So that's what I wanted to answer Chris on that question. So yes, we are looking at this and we are fully aware that this is also one of the components that can put pressure either on the coaches or the gymnast.
Thank you, Nicola. Now we had quite a bit of reaction earlier on when we were hearing from the Bulgarian Federation, and they mentioned about that in their opinion parents should not be going into the gym, and we had a bit of reaction to that. So Donovan Jurgens says, "I accept that parents should not interfere, but why can a parent not attend training? Kindly explain." Sanna Nordin Bates, who is a researcher affiliated with the Swedish Gymnastics Federation, goes a bit further and says the idea of parents not being allowed in the gym has potential problems, given that abuse happens more in private spaces and when coaches cannot be held to account. Can we recommend gyms to close their doors? I believe we need more transparency, not less. And just finally from Andy Gorton, on the same idea really, with all that has gone on in the world of gymnastics over the past few years, how do you expect parents to leave their gymnasts in the capable hands of coaches? Parents need to be involved. That's the way forwards, a triage approach. So gentlemen, this is clearly a complex issue. I'll hand over to you, Nicola.
Well, I think that Alex just mentioned before that made his speech. What can I add to that? Well, for me, once again, we have to find the good compromise. It has been mentioned also that sometimes it's the parent themselves who put a massive pressure on their children or the coach. So that has to be handled. To me, to have the parents attending a training or to be able to discuss regularly with the coaches and to have a careful look on what's happening, I do not see any problem to that. At the contrary, I think that If the parents are in the loop and we can explain them what's going on, and sometimes even what are the problems that the coach is facing with the child or whatsoever, to me this is a bonus, and I will go for it. Honestly speaking, now I understand that not everybody can be in agreement on that topic, and some coaches or federation are of the opinion that there is no place for parents in the training. Well, once again, this is clearly the challenge on what we currently have on the table today, is the different mentalities. Education, once again, what is acceptable in a country may clearly not be acceptable in another country. So to me, I will go for it, and I don't see any problem at all to have the parents maybe not always in the gym with some rules, when they can come, what they can do. But personally, I have no problem with that. I don't know if you, Alex, want to add something to this.
Well, I'll just come back to what I mentioned earlier, which is ultimately what builds trust, what builds an environment that everyone feels comfortable with, where parents feel comfortable leaving their children in the gym. If you achieve that level of trust, I'm sure that every parent won't feel like they need to be around to supervise all the time. And ultimately, that's the goal. And the goal is supporting the child athlete and their development in a safe and most supportive manner. So I think that outright exclusion of parents from the training environment sends the wrong message. It does not build trust. Really what we need is dialogue.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I'm afraid we're going to have to wrap up the session for today, but thank you all for your ideas and input and the questions that you've sent. As I explained a little bit earlier, this session is going to be put online. It will be available on the YouTube of the International, the YouTube channel, I should say, of the International Gymnastics Federations in a couple of days. We're just going to have a couple of messages of goodbye. So first of all, I'm going to hand over to Nicola just to say to sum up before we hear from the FIG president, Morinari Watanabe, in Tokyo.
Well, Andrew, I think that the president had to leave 5 minutes ago. We had to move to another meeting. So I don't
sorry. Okay.
He will do a final speech, but he kindly asked me to try to address you a few words also on his behalf. So once again, on behalf of the president and the FIG, I would like to thank all the participants, all the speakers for this very interesting discussion and for sharing of good practices within the National Federation. Concerning the good practices that have been mentioned, you will have the opportunity, as Andrew mentioned just a little bit before, to review the whole conference soon on the FIG YouTube channel. So that will be available for who wants to have a look at. And once again, I think that this is important, should not hide all this. People who are interested to hear, to see what we are trying to achieve in order to have a better situation should have access to that. So it will be public on the FIG YouTube channel. For the other question, such as Leotard, age of the gymnast, and these topics which will need more discussion and to come to a conclusion as a first step. And as I mentioned during one of my speech, I will inform the executive committee and the concerned technical committees to start the discussion and to find out what would be the next step. We heard from the group of the Nordic country in Europe that they would like to have the opportunity to set a working group. Maybe that's what will happen. I don't know, but this idea will be for sure presented to the executive committee. Last but not least, we will develop a social charter, which will summarize the practices of good conduct and mutual respect in the training or competition hall. From that charter, we're gonna extract 10 10 to 12 golden rules that seems most important to us, even if some of them are common sense. And we are going to create drawings, funny drawings, that everybody will be able to print, display in the training halls or in the premises of the national federations. You will also be able to use them or share them on your social networks. I know that on the chat, there were several questions. People wanted to have a little bit more information as far as the social charter is concerned. I think Catherine was interested also to have a little bit more information. Well, it would not have been fair to come up today and to present you a social charter, say, here we go. No, I think that it has been clear from the very beginning. Before creating that social charter, we wanted to listen to you, to have a better understanding of the problem, of your possible solution, best practice. And then, now that after the second conference, we will have to do a careful analyze of what has been said, what are the proposals, and then to come up with a social charter from which we will extract those golden rules. We still have a long way to go, and I'm sure this is not the last time we will meet to discuss the different problems we face. But once again, I'm convinced that it is all together that we can find the right solution that will allow us to offer a respectful culture and a healthy environment for all people involved in gymnastics. So from me, once again, thank you very much. And I give the floor back to Andrew, because we just learned that the president is still online. So Andrew, floor is yours.
Yeah, sure. And I think I'm just down off camera, but we're just getting a word from our technical guys at the other end of the room. Have we located our president? Well, in that case, I shall hand over to Marinari Watanabe to say a final word as well. Over to you, president. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for the presentator, all presenter, and also all listener. You know, that is fantastic. That's very interesting for the meeting. I'm very happy to the many country is challenged with the change for the culture. You know, gymnastics is a king of the sports. We must be role model of the old sports. We had a bad situation in the past, but today, I trust, I believe we can make bright future with everybody. You know, we are together. If we'll try for the making for the bright future together, together we can do it. We can do it. Yesterday and today is a, this is not final day. This is a first step, first day. So we'll continue for the create for the bright future. Not for me, not for you, for the children and for the world. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for everybody.
Well, thank you very much to the President Marinari Watanabe of the International Gymnastics Federation. And as he says, this is just the beginning, but it is the end of today's session. So once again, a huge thank you to everybody who devoted time and energy to preparing presentations, to sharing their ideas with us, getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning or going to bed at 3 o'clock in the morning and being a part of this interactive forum, which is, I think, you know, the first step, as the president says, in making a positive change in the sport of gymnastics. So from Alex McClin and from Nicolas Bonpane and from myself, Andy Smith, thank you very much and goodbye for now.